Game 1 of the 1990 Championship, and the Wildcats dust the Brisbane Bullets by 6 points in Perth. It was then on to Boondall, and an NBL record crowd watched the home side level the series at one game apiece. Today, the season, the hopes and dreams of rookies and veterans comes down to one game. Hold on to your seats for the most exciting 48 minutes of basketball you're ever likely to see. Today we crown new champions, and may the best team win.
While there were many pretenders at the start of the season, now only two teams remain and they have their last shot at glory this afternoon. Hello and welcome to what will be a thrilling climax to the 1990s NBL season. The Bullets and the Wildcats have one win apiece by around 4 o'clock this afternoon. Will it be Brisbane's name on the trophy again, or will Perth win their first ever championship? Brisbane powered to victory in Friday night's second game to level the series at one win apiece with the support of over 13,000 fans.
Rucker. To beat the Wildcats, the Bullets needed a more up-tempo game. They began like a house on fire. A brutal dunk from Andre Moore as the Bullets race to a 28-20 first quarter break.
What a champ. It's good screens.
It's a grand final, and the Bullets bench was prepared to give blood to the cause as Leroy Loggins, the skipper of the side, began to operate in the second quarter, a three-pointer from wideout. At halftime, the Bullets led 51-37. The Wildcats were in trouble. Enter James Crawford and some powerful dunking. Bullets opened up a 22-point split midway through the third quarter. Even Lord Mayor Sally Ann Atkinson was impressed with that shot from Loggins, but not nearly as much as she was with this dunk from Derek Rucker. The six-footer was leading the Bullets to victory. This shot was from yesterday.
There's Rucker. That's from yesterday.
With 4 minutes left, Perth started to close the gap, and then when Rucker was fouled out, everything started to go horribly wrong. A David Close three-pointer reduced the margin to 6 points as the Wildcats began to claw their way back. But an Andre Moore dunk sealed victory for the Bullets. Coach Brian Kerr knows now he's only one game away from claiming his fifth NBL title.
The Brisbane Bullets 106, the Perth Wildcats 90. That was the result from Friday night. It tied the series at one game apiece, but that score probably not an indication of just the heart failure that the Bullets fans experienced in the last few minutes of the game, because as Glenn Palmer said in that report, the Perth Wildcats closed to within 6 points and victory was in their grasp. But great performance by the Bullets to level it today. One last shot for both teams. Peter Mears heads our commentary team at the Brisbane Entertainment Centre, and Peter, there's every indication that even that amazing crowd figure of Friday night could be beaten this afternoon.
Yes, Pat, we're here again, and once again they tell me there's going to be close to a record crowd, around 13,000 fans here for the decider of the 1990 championship season. They played 36 hours ago, John Musgrove. Will it be survival of the fittest this time, do you think?
I don't think so, Peter. Brisbane had a very good lead-in playing those five games in 10 days. Perth also had a very good lead-in with that tough series against North Melbourne. This is grand final time. Both teams have been at it for 10 months now. I don't think that fitness will really play a big part in it.
Once again, David Christensen's here with us from TVW in Perth. Dave, how have Perth pulled up?
Pretty well, Pete. The tiny Pinder, who's probably one of the key players in this game, knees are always a problem 36 hours after a game, but he won't feel any pain today.
Well, let's look at the two lineups. Firstly, the visitors, the Perth Wildcats.
For the Wildcats, number four is guard Eric Watterson. Number five, Tiny Pinder playing forward. And number six, Mike Ellis hoping to find his shooting touch. Number seven holds the key to Perth's fortunes, James Crawford. And number 10, Trevor Torrance, will he start tonight? Number 11, Steve Davis is a former Queenslander playing forward. And number 15, Ricky Amazing Grace playing guard. Number 23, Craig Evans is a guard forward. And number 24, Rob Dempster back home in Perth's colours. Number 44, the outside bomber, David Close.
Dave, what do you see as the keys to victory for Perth?
Well, I think the first thing they have to do is they have to protect the paint. It's an absolute necessity. They actually out-rebounded Brisbane by two on Friday night, but Brisbane did so much more with their rebounds. Perth have to reduce the number of turnovers. There were a couple that were almost embarrassing on Friday night. There needs to be some backcourt improvement. They have arguably the best guard rotation in the league, but, well, perhaps it was a little AWOL on Friday night. Discipline and concentration is the other thing. Concentration in that they must block out the crowd and everything else about the hype of this game. It's just another game. Discipline, they have set plays, they've got to stick with them.
Cal Bruton, despite a 16-point thrashing in Game 2 after the match, was still optimistic about today's game.
We felt comfortable, I suppose, knowing that it's another game. We didn't play with the sort of desperate attitude that we needed to, and we got to come with a different attitude on Sunday, that's for sure. But We will. It's on the line now. I mean, there's no tomorrows. And as I said to the guys, I believe they worked too long and too hard to just give it away, and that's pretty much what we did tonight.
The Black Pearl, Cal Britton. Will this be his first NBL title as coach? Now let's look at the home team, the Brisbane Bullets.
For the Bullets, number five is guard Darren Breeding. Number seven is Derek Rucker. All the pressure in the world on this man. Number nine, Paul Reese, has shown a lot of aggression in recent games. And number 11, Duncan Johnson, copped a hiding on Friday. Number 12, Greg Fox, a guard that played a defensive role last week. Number 21, Craig Adams, a forward centre on a bench. Number 25, Chris McGraw, the immovable force in the Bullets lineup. The big 3-0 is Leapin' Leroy Loggins. And number 41, the A-Train, Andre Moore. And finally, number 52, Robert Sibley playing forward.
John, what did Brisbane have to do to win this game?
Well, like Perth, they've got to minimise turnovers. In the first game, it was Brisbane that took out the honour in that department. Perth went and reversed it on Friday, and both of these teams have the ability to make the other team pay for turnovers. They've got to keep the game tempo up, which they did on Friday night. They've got to hit the boards, and the big key there is Andre Moore. And they've got to contain Pinder and Grace and try and do it early, get their confidence out if they can.
Despite winning so easily on Friday night, Brian Cool, after his fifth NBL title, is still wary.
Yeah, well, I said to the guys, there's no celebration. We haven't won anything yet. We've just levelled the series, and now we come down to the real hard work. It comes down to one last game of the year, and it'll just be last man standing on Sunday. And so that's what we're going to wait. You know, I'm only worried about tonight's game. I haven't even thought about Sunday's game at this stage.
I'll bet that Curley has thought of nothing but this game over the past 24 hours. Well, there's nothing between these two teams. One all in regular season, one all in the playoffs. Glenn Palmer, what do you think?
Well, Peter, if I had a coin, I'd toss it in the air, because that's just how close it is, and maybe only a toss of the coin couldn't decide the outcome. The trophy is here behind me. Traditionally, these clubs are very, very keen rivals. 12-9, the Bullets lead in overall victories, but that means nothing today. We're 48 minutes away. Well, that's going to be 2 hours, 48 minutes of basketball time to decide who's going to be the champion. It's anyone's game.
It certainly is. I've got a feeling this one is going to go right down to the wire. And remember, there can be only one winner. We'll be back after the break for the tip-off.
McDonald's Flip the Lift. Buy a cup of Coke and flip, flip, flip. Now see what you can win.
It's McDonald's Flip the Lift. Buy a cup of Coke and flip. McDonald's, Kodak, Samsung want everyone to win.
Every time you flip, you win.
Kodak film, bling cameras, cups of food or savings too. Samsung's a blast.
There are hundreds of Samsung prizes to win.
Play Flip the Lift at McDonald's.
And hurry.
They could be in your garden. Cold, lonely little lost and founds. They're hungry and frightened all on their own, wishing they had a nice warm home and some kind, kind person to love them. And then big, happy tears fall from those sad, sad eyes. Give them their bottle. Keep them dry. Because when you find a little lost and found, a lost and found finds love.
Available from Wonderland.
What the heck was that?
Looked like sort of a big turtle in a trench coat.
Everybody knows that Dialer Basket have the original and best gift baskets in Perth. Always innovative, they even have corporate baskets to acknowledge your business associates or staff achievements. These, together with a traditional range of rose, baby, confectionery, fruit and gourmet baskets, make the ideal gift for that special occasion. For your idea or ours, with delivery interstate or overseas, it's Dialer Basket, the original and the best.
Summer long, we're gonna give it to you, boom, 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 boom. We're gonna fill you up, but while we're cooling you down, we're gonna rock. Monsters rock with the chalk, yeah, everybody knows the chocolate milk comes from a chocolate cake.
Welcome back. Another massive crowd assembled at the Brisbane Entertainment Centre for the last one of the year in the NBL season. And also a big crowd assembling in Perth at parties right around the city, hoping that the Wildcats can bring home NBL title number one. No more interested, though, is Robin Ellis, the wife of Mike Ellis, the Perth Wildcats captain. And Robin, I would imagine the nerves are pretty tingling at the moment.
They are. We're quite nervous, but I think we're pretty confident too. I think our guys can do it. Yes, but we've got the whole family here, about 20 of us, all barracking. But I think we can do it, yes, we come out strong.
Have you had a chance to chat to Mike this morning?
Not this morning. I phoned him yesterday. I thought I'd leave him alone for now. But he's pretty confident. You know, he says if we normally have a pretty ordinary game, we come out strong in the second game, and I think that's what they'll do today.
Robin, I know you wish them the very best of luck. We wish them the best of luck too. It's going to be a great game. Thanks for joining us today. And sit back now, relax and watch the game. We're going to take you live to the Brisbane Entertainment Centre. Peter Mears is out there, and game three of the NBL Grand Final Series is about to start.
Thanks, Pat. Yes, and welcome inside to the Brisbane Entertainment Centre. Well, it's happened again. Even though tickets only went on sale this week, there are, I'd say, close to 13,000 fans here again. We set the record on Friday night at 13,221, and I can tell you they're making a lot of noise already. Well, this game sees a clash of two old former teammates and, well, they're now bitter rivals, Brian Curl and Cal Bruton. Looking at their coaching records, well, Curley is the winningest coach in history. He's won four titles. Cal Bruton, as coach, is yet to win one. Overall, Curley is behind Cal Bruton, who's averaged a 73% win-loss record to 69% for Brian Curl. But my tip for this year is that Brian Curl will win that award of NBL Coach of the Year for the second time. Each of them have won it once before. Cal Bruton, after game one, was far from jubilant. He's never done it before, and this is how he spoke to his team after winning the first game of this playoff final series.
And they're going to throw everything at us. And our whole team's going to be ready for it, man.
Yeah, we're going to be
ready for it, man. Hey, good effort, man. Enjoy it for the moment. Congratulations to the crowd. This is the last time we played in front of them this year. Let's bring it all down.
So that was Cal Bruton. I wonder if he can win his first NBL title. The referees today, Bill Mildenhall from Melbourne, Eddie Crouch from Melbourne, and the starting fives, Glenn, I'd imagine, would be unchanged.
Certainly, the Bullets haven't changed their starting five all season. Greg Fox, Derek Rocker, Andre Moore, Leroy Loggins, and Robert Sibley. For the Perth Wildcats, there was a lot of rumours going around that David Close would start. In fact, Trevor Torrence has held his place. Ricky Grace, Mike Ellis, Tiny Pinder, Trevor Torrence, and James, the Alabama slammer Crawford, in the tip-off with Andre Moore.
John Musgrove, a quick word about the way the teams start.
Well, I think the key for both of them is going to settle down as quickly as possible. This is it, the last game. And I think the team that comes out of the blocks quickest, settles down and gets an early lead, will hold the box seat. So both of them will be keen to press the advantage quickly.
Tiny Pinder gets the first possession of the game. It goes to Mike Ellis, who had a quiet game in game two on Friday night. They'll be looking for some improvement from the backcourt, the Wildcats. Torrence, who also had a fairly quiet one. Pinder, whose knees must be a bit stiff, sore, but he'll forget about that pain in this big game. And Perth content to take their time. The shot selection is good, and from the top of the key, James Crawford opens the scoring.
That's pretty well perfect for Perth. They got everybody to have a touch of the ball, moved it around, get a few of the butterflies worked out, and go for a good shot to Crawford. So they started off perfectly.
Look at the matchups. Torrence has Loggins. That's probably going to be the most crucial matchup of this game. Rucker. A little bit of room from Mike Ellis, puts it up, gets his own rebound. He did that an annoying number of times as far as the Wildcats were concerned on Friday night. Pinder though this time, Grace brings it forward. The Wildcats bench up off their chairs already, understandably. Ellis, Pinder, the rotation once again, every player in the team involved. Ellis makes the drive. Dishes out to pin the baseline, the layup works, and the Wildcats go for it.
Well, that's the way they need to start. They've done it well. They've really worked that ball around. The more you keep the possession of that ball, work the clock down, the harder you make the defense work. And everybody feels a little more comfortable having felt the ball, and there have been two very good shots they've picked.
Greg Fox has a foul called on Ricky Grace, who was just a little bit too aggressive in his defense. And Perth has started out much the same way as they started in game one, certainly selecting the right shot. Looking the clock down, but the first foul going to the Bullets.
And that's Greg Fox's job out there as he drives all the way to the front and pulls another foul. Playing a key defensive role for the Brisbane Bullets. He's going to stay on Ricky Grace's hammer the whole night. That foul on Tiny Pinder.
I don't think Brisbane have started out as well as they would have liked to. We just watched Greg Fox again driving through the centre of the key. He'll get a little bit of contact right there across the arm from Tiny Pinder. But Brisbane started up with a wall across the top of the key to try and get Derek Rucker the first shot in first possession. And Perth broke that defensively and stopped that getting away. And now they've come down to look for that drive from Greg Fox. If it wasn't for the foul, I think that they would have picked the Wildcats would have picked that rebound up. So not as much motion in the Bullets starting offensive move.
Greg Fox, who had 20 points in game one, a career high for him. I think the unsung hero with 10 points in game two, but great defense. And he's open to scoring for the Bullets. It's 4-2 to the Wildcats. Grace, double team. Brisbane pressing up in defense, but they break the shackles. Grace brings it up. Across to Ellis. Inside to James Crawford. Kicks it back for an attempted three by Ellis. And it bounces around the rim. And Robin Ellis won't be happy with that. It didn't go in, but at least Tiny Pinder has drawn the foul. Good aggressive play by the Perth Wildcats. And the first personal foul called on Robert Sibley.
I know it's a grand final, but I have never seen a team as pumped up on the bench as what the Perth Wildcats are right now.
The intensity on Tiny Pinder's face as he came down from that was fairly evident as well. So Pinder at the stripe.
Pinder had 16 points in game two after a magnificent game, a match-winning performance in game one in Perth. Fairly quiet, second game by his standards. That's a little short. 5-2, 1-2 for Tiny Pinder. Loggins brings it up. Torrance is on him, working hard on defense. Rucker inside to Moore. He's matching up with Crawford. Out to Fox. The Bullets content to work it around. Perth working very hard in defense. Baseline is Fox. Back it goes with a jumper by Moore, but that doesn't go in. A battle for the rebound. There's hustle on the floor. Anybody's ball. Eventually it kicks away to Crawford. He slips it away to Ellis. Sibley races back in defense.
Both teams want to win this, as was evident on Friday night. They were diving for everything on the ball. Good refereeing. Once again, the referees let the game flow. All incidental contact. Nobody disadvantaged. And it's going to make a spectacle of the game if that continues.
5-2 the Wildcats.
At this stage, it's a dogfight rather than a basketball game.
Ricky Grace looks at the basket, decides to kick it back to Torrance, then to Ellis. The whole of the Perth bench is up again. And they've milked down the time clock and had to turn over the ball, so that was bad play.
They're still taking their time, which is good tactics. They're using the defense and making it work. And that's what they need. Brisbane, on the other hand, are just lacking a little bit of momentum in their offense, still trying to do one-out moves, looking for Derek Rucker to do exactly that. He gets away with it that time. They want him to feel hot, so they're trying to get him to open up fairly early in the match.
Ellis again. Grace. Well, it's a low option pass, cut out by Rucker. Fox goes all the way, makes it off the glass. 5-6, the Bullets in the lead.
The Bullets would like that side of their offense. They really want to run this. Every chance they get off a rebound or out of bounds, they'll try and get that ball up quickly and look for the fast break.
Crawford thinks about going past Sibley. Sibley has other ideas. Grace will take on Fox. Baseline, the little left-hand layup is good. And the lead changes again. 7-6 in favor of the Wildcats. So Rucker settles down the Bullets. Crowd right behind the home team. Fox given room, baseline. Grace takes the rebound from the rim. Has Pinder on his right. Checks. Ellis thought about the three. That pass found Torrance, who turned and made two. All net.
Perth are the ones that seem to be starting with a little more confidence. As we said, both teams want to get out of the blocks early. If you can get a bit of a lead in a game like this, it helps your nerves go and sort of settle a little bit quicker. If you're behind, you're constantly having to chase, constantly having that little bit more pressure behind you and forcing things. Derek Rucker forced into a little bit of a pass under pressure then to Robert Sibley, who just tripped over. But Perth will like this little bit of a buffer, even if it's only 5 or 6 points for a while, just to settle into the game.
Bit of misunderstanding between the two teammates there, Rucker and Sibley. We saw them operate so effectively in game two. Sibley that time losing his balance and turning the ball over. And a foul has been spotted off the ball by referee Billy Mildenhall. Robert Sibley earns up. That's his second personal. Started like a bomb in game two. He had 10 points in the first quarter. He only finished with 12 for the match, but played terrific defense, Sibley.
And his knee's not very good either. Suffering from very painful tendonitis, Robert Sibley. Fatigue is going to be a big factor with the Brisbane Bullets because basically they play the same starting five throughout the whole game.
And they played the fast break style all game. And we saw what happened in the last quarter of that last match as foul is called on Tiny Pinder. Tiny Pinder's first personal foul, and that's the team foul situation, so it's a one and one.
In fact, that's Pinder's second foul.
Second, right.
So,
not a one and one.
Sorry,
it will be. That's right, it's only three. Yes, Tiny does tend to foul early, although in the first game in Perth he didn't. Sibley to Moore. Moore, a nice little move around Crawford. Has an amazingly soft shooting touch, this big man. Good feet. And the fans here love it. So that's 9-8 to the Wildcats.
Well, Tony Pinder's been in this game many, many years, and he knows how to play with a few fouls. He was sitting on four fouls early in the last quarter last week and still played the game out, so that won't be too much of a concern to him, although a good chance to have a break and maybe just again let the nerves and the excitement die down a little bit.
So Steve Davis with the beard is on. Grace goes inside to James Crawford, the Alabama Slammer. Lovely little jump shot over the top of an opponent. And that's 11 points to 8 to the Wildcats.
Very important that Robert Sibley gets down low on James Crawford because he can't match him in the air, particularly when he's suffering from bad knees. And Crawford is going to have Sibley on him all night as well.
Yes, and doubly so, Glenn, because Robert Sibley has a nice little step inside that basket and James Crawford likes to leap for the block. So if you can get him into the air, he has a chance of picking up a foul on him.
That's what Trevor Torrance does best. And that's what the Wildcats do best, that run and stun. We have a timeout at the Brisbane Entertainment Centre. 6 minutes gone, first quarter, the Wildcats lead 13 points to 8.
Hey, Mum, you want it ready to hang curtains? Look at these super prices.
60-centimetre ready-to-hang curtains are $8.95 a drop. 120-centimetres are only $17 a drop. Stove covers are bargain at $3.95 a set. Three-tier storage carts are only $10.95. Cane baskets from a low 50 cents. Large shower caddies worth $3.50, now $2. Set of three duck canisters slashed to $2 per set.
This laundry basket is only $3.95 at WA Salvage. We're not fancy, but we're cheap.
And within a couple of days, the kitchen is like new.
Couple of days? They'd never do it.
Excuse me, I heard that. I'll show you how we did it in 2 days. This is Mid-City Building. They enter all the details on computer, and their huge fleet of radio-operated vans take care of it.
No quotes?
No quotes.
No excess?
No excess.
Like some coffee?
Thanks, but I have to get back.
If you're not with the RAC, you could do a slow burn.
And welcome back to the Entertainment Centre. The Perth Wildcats lead 13-8. It's a replay of that last play. Trevor Torrance on the fast break, as he loves to play. That's typical Wildcats play. When they're flowing, they like to run the ball, run and gun, as do the Bullets.
That's a goal 10. Hit the backboard before James Crawford got to that, so that'll be a goal 10. 2 points to Derek Rucker.
James Crawford's arm was 2 or 3 feet above the hoop there.
Now the shooting percentages are interesting. Perth have shot 86% so far in the game. Brisbane, 37.5. Only 3 out of 8, so they're really shooting bricks. Both certainly content to move the ball around and then look for the open man. Ellis puts up his first shot and it's good. So that's a good omen for the Wildcats. Just 2 that one. 15-10, a 5-point split for the Wildcats.
Both teams extending their defence, going right out to the man, not giving much latitude at all, as we saw on Friday night. That'll go for the whole game. Most of them playing full court of pressure also after a scored bucket, but they will mix it up and change that pattern throughout the game just to try and make the offence look at the defence, take a little bit of time to see what they're doing.
Brisbane press up in defence again, but Davis does well to get the ball away to Ellis, and inside goes the slam dunk from the Alabama Slammer. Makes it 17 points to 12.
Chris McGraw coming out as we watch this once again. Mike Ellis going in a beautiful flick back behind him to James Crawford. And in that close, Crawford knows only one way to score, jam it through. Why not? Spectacular part of the play. But McGraw being brought out now to add a bit more defensive starch in that lineup down low. Probably just go and put a little bit of his body, lay a bit of body onto either Crawford and probably Pinder when he comes in as well.
Credit Mike Ellis with a much better start in this game than game 2. He will be well and truly fired up, the Wildcats veteran. Noticeably though, Leroy Watkins has had a quiet start again. the crowd here will simply be waiting for him to explode, as will his teammates, and I'm sure the Perth Wildcats as well.
Well, we mentioned one of the keys to victory for the Bullets was to keep the tempo of the game up. Perth doing very well to go and be deprived them of that at the moment. They are working the ball around, as we saw there, once again, a drive through the middle, taking their time, plenty of patience, using up the half-court clock.
Great drive, Mike Ellis. Yeah, that was superb stuff from the Wildcats skipper. Rucker. Davis got the hand to it. Torrance, rather, got the hand to it. He's playing good D on Leroy. I don't think Loggins struggles against anyone as much as Trevor Torrance in the league, in fact, though. He's very fleet of foot, ZT. Fox did well to get in there. McGraw has drawn the foul from Steve Davis or Trevor Torrance. Steve Davis up. No, Trevor Torrance it is. His first personal. Quite rightly, Cal Brewton calling for a 3-second call there. The Bullets were in the paint for a long, long time. So it'll be McGraw at the stripe. Bullets down by 7. And the crowd, understandably silent, ready for their whoosh. A well-practiced routine. And they'll be hoping for a lot more of them as this game progresses. Quarter time in game one, the Wildcats led 32-20. Quarter time in game two, it was the Bullets 28-20. So 19-14 at the moment. Grace. Crawford. James Crawford's going to come out of the game for Tani Pinder. Well, that's probably a sensible rotation as long as Davis is doing the job they require of him. Eddie Crouch has seen that.
Chris McGraw was grabbing for the ball and got the player as well in there, and that certainly went and made a difference in the play, so he's going to be picked up for the foul. And the referees are doing very well in that they are allowing the contact in there to go on, so long as it's incidental, there is no disadvantage. That time there was a disadvantage, so they're calling it, and that's great because it opens up free-throwing basketball and lets the players get into the game.
Certainly the Perth Wildcats backcourt is producing much more effectively than in game two. David closes out there. Ricky Grace puts up a three and he makes it. A vital bucket, 22 points to 14. That's the biggest lead of the game. 8 points, Wildcats lead.
Well, the Perth is the team that's got out with the blocks quickest and got that early lead. They'll learn to go and protect that now, and they'll like that little bit of lead. Derek Rucker is going to make it hard to help pull that back, but with a bit of a buffer, Perth can just again take their time, frustrate the Bullets even more. They won't rush their offense. They'll use the clock, make the defense play, and look for the good open opportunities.
Fox dogging Grace like a glove.
This is man-to-man defense at its best.
Hustle for the ball on the ground, close. Just gets it along the ground, back to Davis, and will go out of bounds.
That's a backcourt
ball. It's a backcourt anyway.
I thought for a moment the referee wasn't going to call it.
He did. Eddie Crouch doesn't miss much. Rucker pulls up for the jumper. It's way short. Tiny Pinder.
Mike Ellis got a handle on that. Paid credit to his defense.
Close. Grace decides he might as well shoot it, and he's hot at the moment, so why not? 25-16.
Greg Fox has to come out on Ricky Grace on those. He needs to be the pace and a half away from him, John Musgrove.
Yes, he's giving Grace too much latitude. The thing that's helping Grace too, though, David Close is a threat out there in the three-point line, and he's getting into that position all the time, forcing the Brisbane defense to adjust out wide on him, and then Grace is getting just that little bit more room to move.
Well, Leroy Loggins has lost the ball.
Good defense from David Close.
Was. And Leroy yet to score in the game, so things not going well for Brisbane, but for Perth, everyone's firing. Mike Ellis is going to have a break. He's playing very well indeed at the moment. He's got 4 points, and Eric Watterson's out there.
Duncan Johnson as well.
Duncan's okay. He just had a bruised shoulder from game two.
Greg Fox has gone off for a bit of a rest, and you can't blame him. Chasing Ricky Grace, 15 minutes is enough to make anyone tired.
If you have a chance, watch inside this battle between McGraw and Pinder. There's going to be a lot of contact in there. They're going to try and jockey for position.
Grace over the top of Duncan Johnston. Kicked it away to Pinder and lost it.
Too clever by half.
Yeah, Pinder didn't read it. Duncan Johnston, the rookie who was injured in game two and missed most of the game. Loggins, can he lift the Bullets? They're down 25-16 with 2 minutes to go. Rucker, baseline.
Rucker now looking better.
2 points to Derek Rucker, who now has 8.
Well, if the Bullets are going to bring this lead back a little bit, they're going to have to do it on defense, as they have been doing. Look for the turnovers and try and get a couple of steals, but they're also going to have to block out and make sure they don't give Perth too many offensive rebounds and second shots. And at the moment, Perth ruling that category, as they do once again. Eric Watterson getting in underneath, nobody blocking him out, and still nobody watching him.
Well, there's money for jams. Perth, 3 attempts at shooting it, nobody blocking out for Brisbane, and so the ultimate result, 27 points to 18.
Dreadful defense from the Bullets in.
Yeah, whoever's got Watterson really needs a rap on the knuckles then. He probably was in a help-out situation, but nonetheless, it must have been somebody watching him on that weak side. If you're not going to block people out, they'll certainly get plenty of offensive boards.
Perth getting ready to bring on their 8th player from the bench, Craig Evans. So Cal Root not scared the rotator's bench. A real scrap again. Johnston does the sensible thing and just taps it back to Rucker, who tries to drive. Watterson is there. Johnston given 3-point freedom. Rips out, but Moore is there for the rebound. The turnaround jumper is good for 2. And we have a 7-point ball game again, 27-20.
Tell you what, Andre Moore just has a strange shot. You watch this shot again, it doesn't seem to come off his wrist at all. When we watch him fade away, he just rolls it off his arm. Not a lot of fingers in it, but boy, is it accurate. He gets that up plenty of height, fading away, a bit like Tiny Pinder really, but pushes it off the bottom of his palm.
Andre Moore needed that bucket too, because he's missed plenty from in close. Locking foul. It's on Steve Davis. Now Perth have only one member of their starting 5 on the court at the moment. That's Tiny Pinder. They're running at the moment with Close and Watterson in the backcourt. Evans is a small forward or third guard. And Pender and Davis doing the big man work against McGraw and Moore. The foul under the basket, I think, will be Davis again. It is. And for Steve Davis, that's foul number 2. For the Wildcats, it's the 6th foul of the first quarter.
If we watch this once again, just going through, looking for the contact in there, we see Leroy Loggins go through. The first one's missed. Chris McGraw will go and pick up this ball when it comes through. He'll go up again, and we'll stop it right there. And where we're looking for action is, if we just look way down here, trying to get the chalk in there, just in there with the shoulders on it where the contact occurred.
So McGraw has made the first of his 2. You heard the whoosh in the background. There goes the second. Whoosh again. 5 points to split. Now there's a differential between the game clock and the shot clock. The shot clock says 25, the game clock 27. So the Wildcats will want to milk it as far down as they can, make a basket, and deny Brisbane. Watterson hassled by Johnston. Interesting scrap between these two. Davis set the pick. Evans, quick hands, close, gets it up, back out to Evans. Watterson needs to get the shot away with 3. They missed the violation, that is sloppy.
They missed an opportunity in there too, because Davis had a clear cut to the bucket as he goes and swats it away down the other end.
Steve Davis, sensational.
Their offense working well for the Wildcats, but they must keep watching those other players who are making a couple of holes on the inside.
0.1 of a second is left.
What a maneuver from Steve Davis.
It was 0.1 of a second. The shot's got to go, but it hasn't gone by the time it leaves his hand. A very, very entertaining first quarter at the Brisbane Entertainment Centre. The Wildcats 5 up, 27, plays 22.
There's one undoubted winner in the tyre game. They've got the power. Tyre Power buying power. And they're thrashing the opposition on new tyre prices. Tyre Power have slammed down prices on brand new imported steel belted radials to just $49. And Century batteries are way down in price. They're winning plays the opposition just can't match. If you want imported radials at $49, get on the fast break to your nearest Tyre Power store now. Tyre Power, that's powerful stuff.
It's McDonald's Flip the Lift. Buy a cup of Coke and flip, flip, flip. Now see what you can win.
It's McDonald's Flip the Lift. Buy a cup of Coke and flip. McDonald's, Kodak, Samsung want everyone to win.
Every time you flip, you win.
Kodak film, Bling cameras, cups or food or savings too. Samsung's a blast.
There are hundreds of Samsung prizes to win.
Play Flip the Lift at McDonald's.
And hurry.
There is something to be said about beautiful furniture.
and you'll find Beaumont says it all. Come in and you'll feel relaxed in an atmosphere that only luxury furniture can create. Take your time. Decisions are hard to make when surrounded by elegant, craftsman-built, superior quality furniture. When you're searching for your first or your next furniture setting, consider Beaumont's. Come in and see Beaumont's, the different furniture store, where you're most welcome.
If your home isn't insured with the RAC, and you have a fire, a burglary, an appliance fuse, or break-fix glass, most insurance companies will charge you a hefty excess. RAC Home Guard charges no excess on these claims, so all we do is fix it fast. $99 gives you $15,000 contents cover, and $110 gives you $50,000 cover on your home. So for total security, the right price, and no excess, call the RAC.
Overweight? If you've developed bad eating habits, become lethargic and lack energy, then Trimaway can help you. Trimaway will supply personalised, nutritious, calorie-counted meals delivered to your home from as little as $9 per day. Trimaway can also prepare medical diets for low cholesterol and diabetics. But best of all, there are no membership fees or payments in advance. So why don't you phone Trimaway on 378 2466. That's 378 2466.
And welcome back to the Brisbane Entertainment Centre, where the Perth Wildcats lead 27-22. The top scorers in the first quarter, Rucker had 8, Grace had 8, Moore and Crawford had 6 apiece, Fox, Torrance and McGraw had 4, as did Mike Ellis. So the Perth Wildcats had started on top. A reverse of game 2, where the Bullets had a comfortable lead, an 8-point lead at quarter time.
Starting 5 back on again.
Ellis on Fox, Pinder on Moore, Torrance on Loggins, and that shot is well short, but Torrance will get another attempt, decides to kick it back.
And not blocking out once again, and Pinder getting position, and twice then an offensive position on Andre Moore as well.
Robert Sibley will draw his third foul. That was on Loggins. Loggins it was. So Leroy's had a pretty quiet game, he hasn't scored yet. His first personal foul. Brisbane now have 4 fouls. Perth have 6.
The rebounds at the moment, Perth 10, Brisbane 6. That's one of the telling statistics that can really hurt either team if they go and let that drop. And particularly, as you mentioned earlier, the offensive boards for the Bullets. They must block out, particularly Tiny Pinder. You'd almost have to go and glue yourself to him because the man is going to get plenty of second boards and he doesn't miss a second time. He's dangerous inside.
Another thing, John, another interesting statistic is Brisbane have shot 44% from the field and no three-pointers. Perth 79% from the field, 67% from the three-point line.
Well, 79% from the field is an amazing statistic. Leroy's hot. 2 points.
A team that does take a little bit of patience as they have a turnover. Leroy Loggins picking it up another opportunity, and that falls the second time. Good follow, good rebound, tipping. Perth's high percentage, I think, can be very much accounted for the fact they are playing patiently with their offense and looking for good shots, the right shots, not hurrying their shots, and they are being very patient.
Another stat, 11 assists to 4 to Perth. So it's only 3 points the difference now after it was 5 at quarter time. Pinder has a good look at the basket, decides no, not quite this time.
He's actually held back so far. He hasn't let one go from any sort of range yet.
Perth content to move it around. Ellis dishes off to Pinder. There's that fall away jumper shot. And the Bullets get the possession through Fox off the defensive rebound. Loggins bodies in against Torrance. Dishes off and loses it.
Leroy was looking for bounds. Sorry, Leroy was looking for Robert Sibley to cut in towards the bucket then, and Robert thought it was going to pop out for the jump shot. So miscommunication.
So the Perth Wildcats get the ball, and we've seen a couple of fruitless trips down the court for each team.
Yeah, Carl Bruton not too happy. It's back to a 3-point ball game.
Carl very pumped up for this game. He's looking for his first title as a coach. Of course, he played in 82 against Leroy Loggins, who was with Adelaide then. Lost 85. He played for Brisbane and won as a player. 87, he lost as a coach. And
was a good basket by Crawford. Picks it away to 5 again.
James Crawford playing a much bigger part in the game this week than he has in the past two. 8 points to Crawford at the moment, and looking very dangerous from that little spot just outside the key where he likes that turnaround jumper.
So Sibley going to the line. 31-26. And he hasn't scored a point in the game so far, Robert Sibley, who is suffering from this tendonitis in the knees, but I'm sure he'll play the full game out. The bench boys, McGraw and Johnston.
Players like Robert Sibley and Greg Fox have to do so much defence because they're marking the two most vital players in the opposition lineup. Therefore, consequently, their offensive game sometimes falls away.
So he's made one out of two. And that makes the score now 31-27, just a four-point game.
Steve Davis doing a great job, I think, out there at the moment for Perth.
Yeah, very often an underrated player. Nice assist from Ellis. Up went Moore and has fouled Torrance. But good anticipation by Andre Moore. Knew the pass was going there. Unfortunately, Torrance just had a little bit too much.
Have a look at this replay once again, too, and we'll see where the foul comes down. Andre Moore is actually in pretty good position here when he goes up for the ball. But what happened, we just missed it then, was his hand dropped down and he tried to go and block the ball. Once his hand drops over the body, that's where the contact is going to be picked up and called by the referees. But body position is pretty good.
Trevor Torrance, Calvert. They've missed with every basket missed, I'd say, today. So Fox, with Grace sticking to him, not as closely as he has. Torrance is wearing Loggins like a glove today. Away comes the Wildcats in numbers. Two on one, Ricky Grace to Mike Ellis. Regulation layup, and the Wildcats sprint to a seven-point lead again, 34 plays 27.
It was almost reminiscent of Friday night. The Bullets took the lead on Friday night, got themselves about a 10-point buffer, and the Wildcats had come back. Just as they'd get close, the Bullets would extend again. Now it's going the same pattern, but with the Wildcats in front, they've got a bit of a buffer, about 7 or 8 points. The Bullets get close, and then they start to pull it back again. So, very reminiscent pattern.
Crawford. Oh, what a drive. Couldn't finish the shot off. Some good defense on him. Ricky Grace put a little bit of pace on Greg Fox and has drawn the foul. But in the meantime, we've got a timeout called by the Brisbane bench. The Wildcats leading by 7, 34-27.
The movie that broke box office records is coming to television for the first time.
Ethelmerman jams Russian radar.
You are not funny.
Big dogs landing on my face.
Yes.
If someone is not telling the truth, you say that they are full of...
The man is a walking keg of dynamite.
Tonight, Toyota presents the sensational Robin Williams in Good Morning, Vietnam.
Yeah. Ski-boom, ski-boom. Yummy, 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 yum. Ski-boom, ski-boom. Yummy, 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 yum. Ski-boom, ski-boom.
Welcome back to the Entertainment Centre. We've got 9 minutes and 5 seconds to go till half-time. The difference is 7 points. And as an illustration of how Perth like to play that run-and-gun style, in Game 1, where they won by 6, they had 52 points from layups. In Game 2, where they lost by 16, they only had 26 points from layups. And they're doing it well again today. They're leading on the rebounding 12-8, and on the scoreboard 34-27.
They're looking extremely good, the Wildcats, at this stage too. The Bullets only a shadow of their performance so far on Friday.
This is the guy who's lifting them, the skipper, Mike Ellis, who had such a quiet game in Game 2. That was a great drive.
They pull back to that 9-point safety zone once again. That helps them. Now the Bullets have won. They've got to go and try and change the rhythm again with some good offense. Probably rushing a bit then, Leroy Loggins, and particularly some very, very torrid defense. They've got to go try and force those turnovers again by pressuring the Perth play.
Loggins only has 4 points for the game so far. He's been shut out pretty well. Ellis and Grace doing the job well. Grace to Crawford inside. Reese is on there, tried desperately to block it, but couldn't stop the shot. James Crawford has 10 points for the game.
Maybe Brian Curl's got to look at switching around somebody on Ricky Grace for a while. Maybe putting Leroy Loggins out there with a bit of height and some anticipation, because although Grace is not looking for his shot all the time, he is able to control play and setting up the offense for Perth very well. They need to go and force him to do what he doesn't want to do.
Loggins with a tip in after a long attempt by Rucker. So the score 38-29 to the Wildcats, and Pinder ready to come on again.
You can't teach a basketballer what Loggins did then. That's just sheer anticipation. It comes from being a natural.
Watching Greg Fox play defense here, he's playing very good defense, but you notice Gray's still able to keep control. He's not being forced to go and worry about what Fox is doing against him.
Grace attempting three, doesn't find it. Rucker gets the rebound. Rucker's starting to feel this game now. Almost lost that. Fox decides to drive into Reese, and Reese doesn't miss from there. Brisbane bench starting to get into this game on their feet, urging the team on. It's back to 7, 38-31. A couple of subs being made. Steve Davis and Ricky Grace coming off. Eric Watterson coming on.
A chance to change the defensive assignments now. Good substituting by Perth. They're keeping the rotation moving very quickly. Every time they make a substitution, Brisbane have got to readjust to a new defensive pattern.
Pinder, who's just come on after a break. Torrance. Crawford, the jumper, is short. Again, Rucker gets the rebound. Rucker decides to go coast to coast and draws the foul. Mike Ellis.
Yes, and that'll be two as well. This is where Brisbane look at their dangerous. Once they get into that open court, particularly with the ball in the hands of Derek Rucker, he's got a masterful move with the dribble, and he's so quick on his feet. You can see him going through there, a reaching foul. Just saw it there between the players that picked up Mike Ellis and getting that foul. But they're dangerous in that open court, the Bullets.
Timeout called here at the Entertainment Centre with the Perth Wildcats leading by 7, 6:48 till halftime.
As one of WA's leading financial institutions, Town and Country is deeply committed to our community's quality of life. Mick Malthouse, coach of the West Coast Eagles, has a commitment to excellence in sport. His skill and experience is now a big part of Town and Country's youth development program. Mick is involved in many projects that help the young people of our state grow and develop skills and positive attitudes. Town and Country, we are backing the future of our state because we want them to have every chance in the world.
Do you know what's hot? Hot wings! Yeah!
I can't.
I can't wait.
Kentucky Fried Chicken! Hot wings!
I can't wait.
Spicy! Yo! Crispy! Flavor! Yeah, yo!
I can't. I can't wait.
A new spicy, crispy flavor! Kentucky Fried Chicken! Hot wings!
You can't wait.
Welcome back. Perth lead 38-31. Everybody's here today. There's 13,000 people here at Boondall. And Larry Singstock, the Boomers co-captain, the Gold Coast Cougars skipper, in there doing ABC radio commentary today with Warren Boland.
And he would have mixed emotions. Larry Singstock was a former skipper of the Brisbane Bullets, knowing full well he could well have been here this year had things not gone wrong in the off-season.
Ricky Grace has racked up some impressive stats. He's got 8 points and 6 assists, 4 in the last 5 minutes.
As we're saying about Grace being able to control this game, you can play containing defense on him, but not really able to go and play a defense that makes him adjust his game. And he is very much in control of the ball up the top and getting the offensive Wildcats moving very smoothly.
Rucker has 10 points now. The margin is 5 points. Still Perth lead. Pinder, low post. The fadeaway jumper won't go. It's swatted back cleverly by Crawford. Ellis just calling the shots at the point position.
It'll be interesting to see if the Wildcats do keep that offensive flow going without Ricky Grace on the floor. Newport leadership role needed to be taken up, and they'll be looking to find probably Watterson and Close to work together to try and keep that ball moving and looking for the open players. You've got Pinder and Crawford both out there, so look for the gaps for them as well.
Derek Rucker's first personal foul.
That's Derek Conway, the Wildcats general manager. A concerned look on his face. Even more concerned if the score's very reversed, I would think.
Yeah, I reckon he should be smiling. His team's playing much better than they were in game two. Pinder on Reese. Lost the ball momentarily.
Wow.
Oh, clever steal by Loggins. And it goes to Ruckham for the lay-in. Leroy Loggins, the greatest stealer in the history of the NBL.
And that was great court vision from Loggins. There's another steal from Greg Fox down the other end, who finds Loggins down the middle. Goes and reduces that break by 4 points. 37-38, it's just a one-point game.
Loggins again. Mr. Magic, the money man, he does it all. So it's only a one-point game, 38-37.
The Wildcats, I don't think, can afford to play too much time without Ricky Grace on the court. They lose direction without Ricky Grace.
Yes, indeed. There's a bit of direction there from David Close. You don't often see him drive to the basket. That's a concern for Brian Curl. People do inspirational things in grand final matches, especially the series designer. Derek Rucker. No doubt about his leadership ability on court. 12 points so far. Mike Ellis got the hand in. It should be regulation. And is Tiny Pinder played the trailer in case it was needed. And the Wildcats bench appreciated that.
That was the set play that Mike Ellis knew, that screen off Robert Sibley we've demonstrated on the chalkboard before, and he did magnificently to get in a position over that screen, block the ball, and then go off to the coast-to-coast layup down the other end.
Greg Fox now. Watterson on him. Pinder comes in to help. The man free is Rucker. Gets it back out to Sibley, but Watterson with the steal this time. Crawford to his left. Watterson again. Up went the layup. Crawford almost had the tip in. Tiny Pinder is finally there. And the basket stands. The basket stands. So the Wildcats have weathered a bit of a storm and have come back to lead by seven. The Bullets have called a timeout. Perth side leads by seven, 44 to 37.
Shelley Long and Bette Midler.
A woman has no experience.
We've been through a lot of disgusting things together.
Two very different ladies.
Oh, you are psychotic.
Who have one thing in common, their lover.
Michael!
And when he goes missing...
Police, you're under arrest!
They'll endure just about anything to find him.
Hey, buns, boys, you've been waking out. There's a kidney in Kansas City that's not getting any fresher.
What they'll find is not their lover, but a killer.
He's not going to kill us. Oh, why not? Because we're going to be murdered in this building.
Outrageous Fortune, Monday on 7.
Now, there's a new bank account that does away with juggling money between separate accounts because it replaces them with just one account, does away with the checkbook that doesn't pay interest and gives you the option of one that does, with none of the usual bank transaction charges and keeping fees.
If your bank is costing you money, change your bank. Easy Bank Plus account. One account convenience plus high interest from the R&I.
Welcome back. 4:26 till half time. It's Pickpockets party here at the moment. Eric Watterson joined the party for the Wildcats then with a great steal. Perth have made three steals all in the second quarter. Resultant basket going to Tiny Pinder. And Brisbane have made four steals, of which Loggins has made two vital ones.
We are seeing far more mistakes today than we saw on Friday. The reason is pressure. Look at it again. More turnovers from the Bullets. Easy 2 points for the Wildcats. Mike Ellis playing a key role.
Well, that's inspirational stuff again from the skipper, helped out by David Close. But as Glenn Palmer said, far too many mistakes, and they've come from both sides so far in the course of this game. And I think, John Musgrove, that's simply a result of the pressure.
Yes, we've mentioned both teams had key to victory, and that was to minimise turnovers. We know the pressure's going to be out there, so the turnovers are going to be up. And I still think we're probably right there in the team that goes and gets on top of that quickest and minimises those turnovers could well be in front.
That was simply a case of bad luck for Mike Ellis. Have a look. He tried to take the charge from Rucker and then tripped him with his head.
Yes, well, Eddie Crouch indicated he pulled him down, so it was a bit of tit for tat. Actually, I thought the charge was the first thing.
He was moving, so there was no charge, but it was a great effort.
It was bad luck. Two great competitors, and what a terrific matchup that is.
The one thing it has done is left an awful lot of sweat on the court, and perhaps for the uninitiated who have joined our telecast today, the two little figures in red and blue are taking the sweat off. There's nothing worse, especially for a big man in basketball, than to come down and lose your footing.
So it's 46-37 to the Perth Wildcats.
It's like ice once you get a bit of sweat on there. If you put your foot on it, there's no traction at all. And once again, that buffer zone we were talking about from the Wildcats, the Bullets got it back to within 1 point, and they've now stretched it back to 9 points again. So that pattern's still being followed.
Reese combining well with Moore inside. The two shoot around together, one-on-one, and they showed it there. So it's back to a 7-point split for Perth. Very much a similar pattern to game two, where Brisbane maintained a 7 or 8 point lead up to half time. Ellis, who's leading by example. Close, kicks it inside for Pindo. Bodying up on him is Reese. Does the job well. Blocking out well was Andre Moore. Moore goes for a long shot. Won't go. Gets his own rebound. And the foul.
Tiny Pinder is going to have three. That's going to be a foul on Pinder for grabbing hold of the player going up for the rebound. And that's his third foul. So that'll be a bit of encouragement for the Bullets rebounders in there, because Pinder has been an awful lot of trouble to them all night. And he is still getting those offensive boards because they're not blocking him out.
He's got 6 rebounds and just 7 points at the moment. But he's certainly doing the job inside. He's the leading rebounder in the game. He's sitting down. 46 plays 39. And Loggins makes that 41. Loggins is starting to come into the game more now. He's got 8 points. Close for three. Yes. Radar.
He did that on Friday night to perfection as well. Radar close, as you say they call him. And boy, does that shot go like an arrow.
Rucker, Reese, is playing with a maturity that belies his age. He's played some excellent D on Tiny Pender in 2.5 games. That's a charge from Leroy Loggins. It doesn't matter, Leroy, what you say to Eddie Crouch. First down in the book, see it again.
It's a second foul. I don't think there's too much argument here.
Now, Leroy,
from Steve Davis.
Leroy trying to find him. Leroy there quite plain there, trying to find the path through. Steve Davis, I think, almost faked him out there. Looked as though he was going to go over the screen, but instead stayed just held his position. Leroy didn't stop in time.
Close again. No room to shoot that time. Crawford.
Great pass.
Under the basket, mate. Good possession. That's a basket 10 against Paul Reese, but he got up well, anticipated well. As I said, this young man playing with a maturity that belies his years.
Well, when you look at himself and Heal and young players like that coming through, Justin Cash and Greg Hubbard, it says a lot for Australian basketball in their backcourt. They've got some great talented shooters and some very good court generals.
Johnston, another very talented young player, almost said junior. The foul, no basket though, from Eddie Crouch. He's generous, but not that generous. The foul is on Mike Ellis. I'm sorry, and for Mike Ellis, that's foul number 3 as well. So there's a worrying trend for the Perth Wildcats, John. 3 to Pinder and 3 to Ellis.
Yes, it might be a matter of attrition there for the Bullets to go and grab this lead, though, because they really are throwing everything at the Wildcats, and still the Wildcats hang on to a 10-point break. And it must be frustrating. Well, it is frustrating for any team to keep pushing and pushing, getting these breaks and a couple of turnovers, doing everything you can, still look up the scoreboard and see the lead hasn't been reduced any.
And Carl Bruton still showing great faith in his bench. Robbie Dempster has come in. A much-travelled basketballer. He's played for Illawarra and Newcastle as well as Perth. So Dempster in, 9 players used off the bench so far. Reese makes both, 43 trails 51, the Wildcats still out by 8.
Paul Reese doing everything his coach would have asked of him. But Perth still clinging to this lead. That's Robbie Dempster. He's on Andre Moore. He's renowned as a stopper rather than a scorer. Baseline drive by Ellis. Kicks it back to Crawford. That shot's an air ball. But regained by Ricky Grace. The foul is called. Tiny Pinder urging on his team. Really getting hyped up on the bench.
Well, once again, it was that very simple basic the Bullets must focus on. Blocking out Ricky Grace, one of the smaller members on the court out there. He can certainly leap, but the size a bit small, being allowed the freedom of getting inside and getting up that second opportunity.
Well, there's supposed to be a law in the NBL that only the coach is allowed to stand up and walk down courtside. We've got the coach, the assistant coach, and 5 players standing in front of us. So you have no chance of calling the game unless you look at your monitor, but that's what we have it for, so everyone's very pumped up. Ricky Grace has 12 points for the game. 53-43, that's a 10-point split. Just under 2 minutes to go for halftime. Moore. Plenty of room to shoot. Swatted back by Crawford, but the second attempt is good. Very clever the way he maintains his balance in those situations. The Bullets pressing up in defense. and they go back to the set offensive position, the Perth Wildcats. Ellis on Johnston. Dempster tries to do his stuff on Moore, then kicks it back to Close. Could be almost a turnover. It's off the foot of Loggins, so that'll be a Wildcats ball.
Well, that was more good luck than good judgment. The Wildcats retained that.
They're just looking to see the clock. Shot clock's only got 5 seconds on it. The referee ruling that was a defensive play, so they don't reset the clock, so the Wildcats must shoot it, as Grace does. And you can't get a better result than that.
What a shot. That came out of the bleachers with all the pressure in the world on that man. That is an amazing basket. 56 plays 45. The 11-point split, and that's as far out as they've been. Rucker. Johnston. Well, Leroy made the cut. Johnston didn't know it was coming. Or in that case, didn't know he was going. But when he did, Close, Ellis, Grace.
Perth should run it right down.
I think they're going to try. Grace goes in and has drawn the foul. So that's intelligent play from Ricky Grace.
3 fouls on Loggins.
Yes, I think when Brian Curl goes back to the dressing room at halftime, his number one priority is going to have a talk on how do we stop Ricky Grace running the show. So not just his scoring, his 15 points have been very valuable, but he must have close to 10 assists by now, and he is setting up the offense very intelligently, making sure they don't rush and panic. So they've got to do something to make Grace take his focus off the rest of the team and start worrying about the defensive man in front of him.
So Grace at the stripe for 1-1, has to make the first, and does. Wants to know why he's not shooting too, because he wasn't in the air or in the act of shooting when he was fouled. But I guess you might as well ask.
You don't ask, you never receive.
The second has the crowd and the band against him, but has his concentration on his side. 30.3 seconds. The smallest of differentials between the shot clock and the game clock. Assuming the Bullets run this all the way down, the Wildcats will have about a second in which to get a play away, if that's the case. Rucker is content to work the clock down. He'd like to take his team in settled at half-time. Far better to go in with a basket than to go in without one. Johnston puts it up, makes two. The clock keeps rolling. 3 seconds. I don't think they'll get a shot away. The Brisbane D is too good. Ricky Grace lets one go. Well, he hit the backboard, and I guess that in itself is an achievement. The Perth Wildcats, though, go to the locker rooms with the advantage. 27-22 at quarter time. They lead by 11 at half time, 58-47.
Sheet metal can stop this happening to your car. Add remote control to lock in your valuables. TG Sheet Metal are manufacturers of the award-winning glider roll roller doors, up to a huge 5.4 meters wide, plus tilt and sliding doors are also available. So be confident in buying the best door with the option of remote control security. Give TG Sheet Metal the chance to quote for you today. TG Sheet Metal, technology and strength in steel.
The limited edition 1.8 litre Nissan Pulsar Reebok. With $2,500 worth of extra value at no extra cost, you'd better run for it, or you'll miss out.
It's a Nissan, that's my car.
Midnight Oil's latest, Blue Sky Mining, along with 8 more albums and a live video, in store now.
Chicken treat special.
Hey, chicken and chips, chicken and corn, Hawaiian back. A chicken dinner. Yo, it's a chicken treat special. Can't you see? Buy any quarterback and get a Coke for free. That's a quarter of chicken in every pack, and a free can of Coke that will wash it back. It's a chicken treat special. Chicken and chips, chicken and corn, Hawaiian back. A chicken dinner. Grab a quarter pack from your chicken treat store. Get a free can of Coke. Who's gonna ask for more? Yo, a chicken treat special.
Done. Well, almost. Next time, don't just wash your car, revive it. With Wins Revive, just watch. Revive silicone formula beautifies and protects dashboards against aging, hardening and cracking. Outside, tyres, bumpers, and Revive is detergent and water resistant too. So buy a bottle of Wins Reviver next time. Don't just wash your car, revive it.
Because when it's Wins,
it works.
Australia, get ready for the biggest concert event since Woodstock. On the 24th of November, the cream of Australia's rock industry will gather on five stages around the country for a rock show that will rival even the legendary Live Aid benefit. It's called Oz Music 90 for the development of our nation's music talent. Brought to you by Coca-Cola.
Welcome back. Well, at half-time, the Perth Wildcats in charge of this game. They lead by 13 after leading by 5 at quarter time. And they've thoroughly deserved it. They've certainly shot better from outside. They've landed 4 bombs and the bullets haven't landed any. And they seem to be much more settled and not giving away as many fouls as they were in the first match we played here in Brisbane, which was game 2 of the finals. Looking at these stats, you can see that Brisbane have got 10-11 to Perth. Not much in that, not much in turnovers. Rebounds are significantly Perth's way, 17-13. Field goals are much the same, but look at the three-pointers, Dave. That's been vital, and Ricky Grace has shot some incredible baskets.
Well, Ricky Grace and David Close, but I think probably the most inspirational basket in the first half is that drive of Mike Ellis's.
Yes, we'll come back after the break and have a look at the Mazda Slam Dunk draw for the contest for 1990. But in the moment, just for the time being, we'll throw to a break.
Now, there's a new bank account that does away with juggling money between separate accounts because it replaces them with just one account that earns terrific interest calculated daily. But, unlike others, this amazing account is free of all the usual bank transaction charges and keeping fees.
If your bank is costing you money, change your bank. Easy Bank Plus Account. One account convenience plus high interest from the R&I.
Excuse not to enjoy the benefits of milk every day. Four ways.
Number one
is regular mum.
Have you had it today? Number two,
maybe skim for you.
Have you had it today? Number three,
it's high-low for me.
Have you had it today? Number four,
high calcium for sure.
Have you had it today? Have you had it?
Pure fresh WA milk.
Have you had it today?
It's McDonald's Flip the Lift. Buy a cup of Coke and flip, flip, flip. Now see what you can win.
It's McDonald's Flip the Lift. Buy a cup of Coke and flip. McDonald's, Kodak, Samsung want everyone to win.
Every time you flip, you win.
Kodak film, bling cameras, cups or food or savings too. Samsung's a blast.
There are hundreds of Samsung prizes to win.
Play Flip the Lift at McDonald's.
And hurry.
Kmart is the best value toy store in Australia. You'll find all the famous toy brands and all the most wanted toys. And every toy is at Kmart's discount prices. As well as Australia's biggest and best value Christmas bear at $28, these lovable bears are also available for only $18 if you buy $35 worth of merchandise. There's no deposit lay-by. You can pick up the toys Christmas Eve. So, who's Australia's best value toy store by far?
Welcome back. Well, the Mazda Slam of the Year contest has been one of the features of our seven sport coverage of basketball right throughout the season, and we now come to the drawing of the winners. Let's have a look at the best slams of 1990, starting from number 7 right through to number 1.
In 7th place was Slam E from the Canberra Cannons, Emery Atkinson.
Will that ignite the Cannons? Just a plain give and go play.
Sixth was Slam A from the Geelong Supercats, Darren Rowe. Fifth was Slam F, the Brisbane Bullets, Dunkmaster, Andre Moore. Fourth was Slam B, the Wildcats, Alabama Slammer, James Crawford. Third was Slam C, the Illawarra Hawks, Patrick Airfair. Second was Slam B, the Gold Coast Cougars, Leroy Combs with the Tomahawk Jam.
That was the play of the day.
And the winner with the reverse slam dunk from the Hobart Tassie Devils, Steve Fife.
Reverse dunk.
So there they were, and you had to try and rank those in order from 7 to 1 and see if your choice corresponded with the NBL General Manager Bill Palmer's. And the winner was Cheryl Ashmore, 1 Abercrombie Street, West Wollongong, New South Wales. And your prize is a sensational 1.8 litre 323 Mazda sedan. Fantastic prize. Of course, you've seen it right throughout the season on our NBL show. And Cheryl Ashmore from West Wollongong will be driving away in one of those magnificent cars. Don't forget, at halftime, the score 58 to 47 in favour of the Perth Wildcats. The individuals, Grace has 17, Rucker has 12. We'll come back after the break and talk to the coaches.
Done. Well, almost. Next time, don't just wash your car, revive it. With Wins Revive, just watch. Revive silicon formula beautifies and protects dashboards against aging, hardening and cracking. Outside, tyres, bumpers, and Revive is detergent and water resistant too. So buy a bottle of Wins Revive and next time, don't just wash your car, revive it.
Because when it's Wins,
it works.
Have you heard that ABC blinds guarantee to beat any quote? Hey, do I know you guys? You want top quality. That's why I call ABC. And ABC blinds have a huge range so that they can decorate your entire home. They even look great in my bathroom. Hey, come on, man, get out of my bathroom. If you got a problem with privacy, call ABC. ABC blinds, top quality. But when it comes to price, they'll beat it.
The most fully featured family saloon under Australian skies is under $25,000. The Mazda 626. With air conditioning, power steering, cruise control, power windows, central locking, electric mirrors, and fuel injected 2.2 litre power. All for just $24,990. No wonder it's creating such a storm.
It's McDonald's Flip the Lift. Buy a cup of Coke and flip, flip, flip. Now see what you can win.
It's McDonald's Flip the Lift. Buy a cup of Coke and flip. McDonald's, Kodak, Samsung want everyone to win.
Every time you flip, you win.
Kodak film, bling cameras, cups of food or savings too. Samsung Double Blast.
There are hundreds of Samsung prizes to win.
Play Flip the Lift at McDonald's.
And hurry.
All summer long, we're gonna give it to you. Boom, 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 boom. We're gonna fill you up while we cool you down. We're gonna rock. Masters rock with the chalk. Yeah, everybody knows the chocolate milk comes from a chocolate cow. We're gonna rock with the chalk. All summer long, we're gonna rock. Masters chalk, let's rock. Boom, boom.
We hope you're enjoying this telecast of the 1990 Kmart Final Series.
The Entertainment Centre. At half-time, the Perth Wildcats leading by 11 points, 58 to 47, and they're leading in the rebounding, 17 to 13. Ricky Grace is the outstanding player in the game. He's nailed 3 three-pointers in his 17 points, and I think Glenn Palmer, he's been the outstanding player, really. He's led from the front.
Most definitely, Peter. Ricky Grace has been the Wildcats' general so far, and with him on the court, they seem to have so much more composure, and composure is something that has been
lacking in the bullets today. Too many shots have been undisciplined, and I must admit the boys are looking tired from the Brisbane bullets. Leroy's looking tired, Robert Sibley in particular, having trouble getting up and down on the floor. And at this stage, you'd have to favour the Wildcats. I know there's still two quarters of basketball to go, but the Bullets are looking down the barrel of a defeat, and it'll be their first defeat in the playoff game at home this year.
Perth have shot 70% to Brisbane's 53%, and Ricky Grace, I think it's interesting to look at his individual statistics. From the field, he shot 72%. From the three-point line, he's only missed one, 75%. 100% from the stripe, six assists, a steal, and four rebounds. That's a match-winning stat sheet.
Of course, the crowd factor can still G up the players even though they're tired. Perth are using the fact that there's 13,000+ people here as an anti-stimulant, if you know what I mean. As far as the Bullets are concerned, they've got to get the crowd on their side now. It's about all that can lift them at this stage. Brian Curl, definitely a worried man at halftime. He said the Bullets have got to go back to the basics. They've got to do the things that they've been doing all season, and that is go to their money men, Rucker and Loggins and Andre Moore.
Looking at the assists, Perth have 17 to Brisbane's 9. In the rebounding, as I said, 17 to 13 Perth's way. Virtually everything is going Perth's way. Ellis has shot 86% from the field. And let's go to Dave Christensen now. He's with Dave Hancock, the assistant coach for the Wildcats.
Dave, it's been just the start, I gather, that you wanted, but amazing percentages from the field, 70%, 67% from the outside area.
Yeah, well, we're taking our time today and working the ball for 20 or 30, you know, well, sometimes 30 seconds, and that opens up the defense and gives us a lot better percentage shot.
Well, in fact, once you work it for more than 30 seconds, Brisbane started playing very good D. You've started to work around that now. What's the tactic for the second half?
Well, we're not going to change very much. We feel if we keep them on defense and they don't have the ball, obviously we got a better chance of winning, but it also helps our defense. We cut down their fast breaks, we take better shots, and they can't fast break on us, and that's the big key.
Also, 9 of the 10 players off the bench have had a run. You're getting great rotation, but some of the substitutions are baffling, at least us, if we're not masters of the game.
Well, we're just trying to get some time out of some of our 9 and 10 players right now and bide some time with Tiny and James on 3 fouls. So,
yeah, is that a worry to you, Tiny's foul count?
Well, sure it is. It's so Steve's, but we got 4 fouls between him, and that's what we got to come out of in the rest of the game.
The Loggins factor, you've contained Leroy so far?
Well, we got Leroy in a bit of foul trouble, and that's a big key for us. If we keep taking the game at him, maybe that'll come our way.
Okay, Dave, thanks very much. Good luck, second half. Yeah.
Hancock talking with Dave Christensen from Perth. John Musgrove, Brisbane Bullets haven't really maintained those keys to victory you were talking about.
No, I was in the dressing room at halftime, and Brian Curl really summed it up in that their two big keys that they needed to go and watch very closely, the Bullets, were the block out on the offensive boards. They've given away 8 or 9 of those in the last half, and all of them have been converted, and also their defence just hasn't been as strong as what it has needed to be.
There are the top scorers in the game. Ricky Grace, the leading scorer, has 17. Derek Rucker has 12. Mike Ellis, much improved performance, only 2 points last game, 12. And Leroy Loggins starting to come into his own now with 10 points, as has Andre Moore and James Crawford.
A big difference between Friday night, Peter, as you look at the score. On Friday night, the Bullets were able to contain the Wildcats down to 40 points. Tonight they're 58 points. That's 18 points of difference, and that really has come from not as strong a defense. That's been the real big key to allow those. The Wildcats, on the other hand, have done pretty well to keep the Bullets down to around about the target they'd want them to be.
So away we go for the third quarter of this game. The Perth Wildcats leading by 11 points. Can they maintain?
And the Perth Wildcats have won every tip-off so far in the grand finals here in Brisbane.
One thing on the board that Phil Jauncey must have written, I think, for the Bullets that I did like, and it applied to both teams. It takes 9 months of effort to get the chance. It takes 48 minutes of work to make it worth it.
Well, we'll find out in another 24 minutes of basketball. That's all that's left. Rucker back to Fox. Bullets playing pretty well at the moment. Rucker drives to the key and draws the foul.
No foul.
No foul?
No, just hit out of bounds.
Just knocked out of bounds, sorry.
17 seconds left on the shot clock.
There's another turnover, and it's those little mistakes that make a big difference in a game like this. 1 or 2 points, and that loose ball can count.
So the shot clock now 25 seconds. Plenty of time for Perth. Grace.
Both sides guilty of losing touch of the ball.
That's prefer to see what Greg Fox is doing now. As we mentioned in the first half, he's got to make Grace work. He can't afford to let him stand out there and dribble the ball around watching for something to happen. If he can get Grace's eyes off what's happening under the key, more concentrated on him, it's going to make it harder for the Perth offense to go and find the right shot.
So Grace scores the first points of the second half. It's now 62-47.
Sibley unable to find the range from that close. Had a quiet first half by his own standards, but will come back.
John Musgrove, when you think that as Quinter makes a drive to the bucket, puts his foul over the baseline, but it was blocked by Moore anyway. John Musgrove, one question. When do you think the Bullets will resort going exclusively to Rucker, as we've seen them do all year?
I think they'd save that right down to the end if they had had to really go and pick up points very quickly in the last couple of minutes. But we said against Eastside, all the team has to do in these situations is be in a position to win in about the last two or three points. If they're within about 10 minutes to go in the with 3 minutes to go, they're in a position to win. Both teams are. Because anything can happen in this game in those last couple of minutes. So the aim has just got to be as close as you can with about 3 minutes to go.
Still, 24 minutes or so of basketball this half, it's a long time.
As we saw with Tiny Pender's knees, it wasn't evident then as Torrance makes the baseline drive, pulls back, lets one go, and from 10 feet puts it through his all net. So 62 plays 47, and Rucker once again to bring the ball forward for the Brisbane Bullets. The crowd would love to be making more noise. They're looking for some sort of incentive to do that. Rucker puts it up, a little help from both sides, and down it goes. Still a 13-point split to the visitors. 62 plays 49, 9.5 left in the third quarter, so it's still anybody's game. Crawford, lightning pass, Grace can't convert, gets up again for the second shot, and that falls.
And another offensive rebound converted for the Wildcats, makes about 10 this game, that's 20 points from second opportunity.
The Bullets big men are not doing their job, and Ricky Grace can get the rebound.
Rucker, they mainly hit to start letting loose with a few three-point bombs again.
That's a fall-away shot that would be hard to match with anyone. Pure Ellis. Athleticism.
Ellis takes on Loggins, then comes back. Allow Grace to set it up. It's Kinder coming towards him, but drives away. Crawford, Ellis baseline. Underneath Sibley, dishes back out to Grace. Well, low option pass. Andre Moore read it well, but it should never have gone to him. Rucker, Loggins. Basket 10, but didn't James Crawford get up high again?
Well, I think that's 6 points now the Bullets have scored this game on goaltending, and all of them coming from the hands of James Crawford. Just doesn't know his own spring of times right above the ring. His elbow's almost collided on the front of the ring.
So a couple of changes being rung in. Greg Watterson coming on for Ricky Grace.
They thought about bringing Crawford off, but it thought better of it.
So Perth bring the ball up through Watterson. To 53 to Perth. Crawford can't get past Sibley. To Torrance, the turnaround jumper is short. Knocked back to Loggins. Crowd likes that.
The Bullets desperate for a three-pointer at this stage. Rucker puts up a shot. It doesn't go.
And Pinder again.
Bullets have yet to land a three-pointer in the game. As Perth have got four. Sibley at this moment only has 1 point for the game and no rebounds.
One thing the Bullets might need to do when they go back down in offense is to try and take it in against Tiny Pinder a bit more. With three fouls, he is susceptible as a three-pointer comes from Ellis. But with nine rebounds, Tiny Pinder is really one of the big keys at the moment for the Wildcats. So many of those on the offensive boards too. So they need to try and get him into a bit of foul trouble if they can.
Mike Ellis, 15 points. That's his first bomb. Fox drives in. Sibley didn't read the pass. It's a turnover again. And the Bullets are gradually playing themselves out of contention. They're down by 14.
Still a long way to go. Fox is playing very good team. At least this far out. Torrance. Rucker has the defensive assignment on Trevor Torrance. And a foul called off the ball. Blocking foul.
Tiny Pinder too. That's his fourth.
Well, Tiny Pinder.
That's about the last thing the Wildcats needed. A Tiny Pinder isn't all that happy. Steve Davis goes over and just Tries to call him a little bit.
Well, we said they needed to take the ball at Pinder in offence to try and draw some fouls off, and we didn't expect them to happen. They were playing down on the offensive end. That's a bonus, really, for the Bullets.
You can read lips. Tiny just said there ain't no way. Unfortunately for the Wildcats, the whistle's gone. It don't matter what you say. Leroy loses the hand on it, regains it. Brace came over the top and was lucky not to be called for a foul. Davis, Perth's quiet achiever, Steve Davis. Brace calls for the rotation. It's Torrance rotating forward. There he is. He'll go baseline, dish back out to Brace. He thought about shooting, eventually puts it up. The basket stands.
Four fouls on Loggins.
The basket stands. He'll get the bonus. And as Glenn Palmer said, more importantly for the Wildcats and certainly for the Bullets, a fourth foul to Leroy Loggins.
Yes, and that's going to even things up a little bit. Tiny Pinder, really the linchpin for the Wildcats now on the bench with four. We're still 6 minutes and 12 minutes in the next quarter to go. But even a little with Loggins in there on a fourth foul as well.
Would you leave Loggins in there?
Yeah, Leroy, I think, is one of those players who really can play with four fouls. And at the moment, he's when you're 14 points down or more now, 17 points down at this stage, you really can't afford to take him out.
So this is the biggest lead of the game for the Wildcats. Loggins has to produce something now. He misses with that shot. Playing his seventh grand final, Leroy, and everyone expected he would be the difference in favour of Brisbane.
17
he's
points.
Only got 12 points.
17 points is a huge split now for the Bullets to have to come back and break.
Yeah, we saw the Wildcats on Friday night, 22 points. They were down in that last quarter, bringing back the 4 or 5. Basketball is a game of momentum and rhythm, so I wouldn't write any team off at this stage, but certainly I think the Wildcats would enjoy the buffer they've got at the moment.
Brilliant reject by Andre Moore. Great defensive play. Rucker bumping aside Watterson. Fox dishes off. Sibley loses it. Can't do anything right.
This is one thing you can't do in basketball. If you're going to go and penetrate, you must know what's going to happen when you penetrate. You can't just dribble into the keyway and hope something will open up.
Timeout called with the Perth Wildcats in charge here in the third quarter, 70-53.
Australia, get ready for the biggest concert event since Woodstock. On the 24th of November, the cream of Australia's rock industry will gather on 5 stages around the country for a rock show that will rival even the legendary Live Aid benefit. It's called Oz Music 90 for the development of our nation's music talent. Brought to you by Coca-Cola.
Where I come from, you need a tough bike. An Aussie tough bike. Not some fancy Nancy import. A real brute like this Gordonson Pilbara. A mountain bike with guts to go. Of course, it's got to be a bit sensitive too. Fast response 10-speed gear shift and comfortable seat and handlebars. The Gordonson Pilbara, built for people who beat their bikes about. There you go, Emma, do your worst.
Dad. The Pilbara, only at Gordonson Cycles.
And welcome back to the Entertainment Centre. 5:39 to go, third quarter. That's the score, 72-53. And the Bullets conceding a lot of turnovers in the last few minutes, John.
Yeah, again, going back to that key, reduce mistakes. At the moment, they're forcing the mistakes, and a lot of them has come from that, as I said just earlier, penetrating the keyway and not having somebody to go to. You must know where the lane is going to be there and who's going to fill in, not hope that it'll happen when you get in there.
Tiny Pinder's sitting down with 4 fouls. Ricky Grace puts up a short attempt, comes back to Rucker. Crowd here at Boondall just waiting for Rucker to ignite them, and he does. That's the one they wanted. First bomb of the game that Rucker has landed. That's 19 points for him.
And the Bullets have switched to a zone defense. They weren't getting enough rebounds out of the man-to-man, so they'll go and put the triangle in the back that they'll get in a 2-1-2 zone and hope they can block out. It'll also lessen the chances of Leroy Loggins hopefully picking up that last foul.
Of course, that'll open the door for David Close to let loose with some bombs. And here he goes with one now. He'll make this one.
He never misses, it seems. Well called, GP. All game, Perth is shooting 68% to Brisbane's 50%. And in the three-point area, they're out shooting them by 6-1. And the bench just loving it.
Isn't that a great way to break a zone? No better way. If you can have your outside shooters bombing from out there, they'll break it pretty quickly.
So it's the Rucker Moore show again. That's a turnover. Eventually it comes back to David Close. It's a rebound, I suppose.
The way he's going closer and could have shot it from there.
The way he's going at the moment, he could.
It hardly seems fair when you can shoot that well.
He puts a lot of practice in. There's nothing else in practice, it seems. Watterson looks at the basket. Loggins tries to get the steal, but misses.
3 seconds.
And it comes down through McGraw to Sibley. So good defense by the Bullets.
Tony Robert Sibley's second rebound for the game. He's certainly playing with an injury.
And Andre Moore, after picking that 14-15 up on Friday night, also being held to 5. So those two must make a turnaround in the last quarter to bring the Bullets back into it.
The reinforcer, Chris McGraw, all 110 kilograms of him with that lovely soft shot. The jumper, it makes it 73-58.
Mike Ellis back in the game for the Wildcats. Reading the program for this game, Coach Brian Toole's philosophy for success, rebounds plus defense equals championships. They went halfway, that he said, on Friday night with their defense, lost the rebounds by a tad. Tonight, I think they're losing on both accounts. Their defense not up to the scratch it was on Friday, and they're down by 3 or 4 in the rebounds at the moment.
The Bullets still in the 2-3 zone, and that's the perfect retort. That's 2 3-pointers when the zone was on. It's not working.
18 points to split, 3 minutes remaining in the third quarter. That's as far out as the Wildcats have been. That's a very, very comfortable margin to have. McGraw, bearing in mind that very often the third quarter is the quarter that wins or loses championships. Interestingly, no team which has won the second game of the Grand Final Series has ever taken the title. There's only been two that have got the 3 games.
The Bullets just can't win a board at the moment.
Bounce pass, Hines close, regulation layup for 2. On that occasion, the Wildcats had 2 to beat 3 and did it. 20 points with 2.5 minutes to go. 20-point lead and some nerves starting to rattle, I'd say, in the Bullets' cap. Rucker, they need to go with a few threes. Crawford, another monster rebound for the Alabama Slammer. And the Wildcats content now to milk the clock on every occasion. They can effectively begin to let the air out of the ball. And against the zone defense, I guess, John Musgrove, it's a little easier to do.
Yes, and they will be able to use that time, as you say, and frustrate the Bullets even more. But I think the defense of the Wildcats is doing enough frustrating down that end, their offensive end anyway, because they have just forced the Bullets into making mistakes.
So, double turnover there. The Wildcats got a new shot clock, and that does the Bullets more harm. 1 minute 45 left, third quarter. Ricky Grace makes the drive to the baseline. It's come off a Bullet hand. And will be a Wildcats ball at the side with 11 seconds left on the shot clock.
Just been handed the crowd figures, Dave. 12,560 here for game 3. 12,500. And Mike Ellis at this stage has 7 assists.
And I think that would have been an NBL record had it not been for Friday's crowd.
Now, when you think about it, there were 8,000 in Perth. 13,000 here the other night. That's amazing. It shows the growth of basketball. 33,800 people have witnessed this series in person.
It's a fairly good indicator too that maybe a best of 5 series throughout it do the crowds a heck of a lot of good in overall attendances.
Not actually sure that the connective tissue around my heart would appreciate it.
Not a bad gate for the Brisbane Bullets either. The NBL give the Brisbane Bullets $14 out of the $15 admission fee. So that'll boost junior basketball in this state.
Ellis makes the first of 2. The lead is out now to 21. And if you reflect back, it was 21 points that the Bullets led by on Friday night. Now 22, 58 plays 80. The lead simply keeps extending. It's gone from 11 at half-time, so the Wildcats have doubled their lead in 10 minutes and 30 seconds of basketball. McGraw. Let me hasten to add, though, this game is not over. Although it will be if the Bullets don't tighten up on the offensive boards.
Yes, they're losing it themselves at the moment. Very loose. They've got to go back as they have to a man-to-man defense, try and force some mistakes. And they've still got plenty of time. They've got to be more patient in offense. They're just rushing things at the moment. But full credit to the Wildcats' defense causing a lot of that rushing.
John Musgrove, also perhaps this is where the Wildcats experience Ellis, Crawford and Pinder, 24 years of NBL experience between them, is starting to show.
And we said right at the beginning of the game, the team that got out of the blocks quickest would be the one that probably had the advantage making the other team play catch-up basketball, and it seems to have been pretty true. The Wildcats got that lead early, and they've had that buffer pretty well all the way through.
I imagine they're very excited in the Ellis household back in Perth. They're watching this game, as no doubt everyone is in Perth. 82-58, and that's a poor shot by Trevor Torrance, an air ball.
It's time now for Derek Rucker to start operating. He really needs to start hitting the threes. The Bullets can't win it by just scoring 2 points up and down the floor.
Box dishes off. Sibley all the way. Won't go. Still won't go. Can Rees put it in? He's been stripped of the ball, but he'll draw the foul. Well, the Bullets at the moment just can't get an offensive board without losing it, John.
Well, they're causing that themselves too, because the last four or five trips down the court, they have just crowded, instead of spreading their offense, they've just crowded the keyway. And you've had 10 guys in there, including Perth players. If you're going to go in that into that situation, the bigger and more powerful players are going to win. And that the players like Davis and Crawford out there at the moment.
Time for one last shot before three-quarter time. The lead is 22 points. Rucker puts up the shot. It doesn't go. But a foul is called.
Ricky Grace, third foul. If it is Grace.
Very hard to see with Cal Bruton.
Yes, it is.
Dave Hancock forming a nice screen in front of us.
Well, that's third foul, two in the last 15 seconds.
No team has ever come back from a deficit of 22 points to win an NBL match.
I think we were saying the same thing on Friday night in reverse, weren't we?
Yeah, three-quarter time, that is.
The interesting comparison is Robert Sibley misses his first in the offensive styles of the two teams. Watch how the Wildcats, when they go down, spread that offense out. Use the whole court, pass it around, keep the ball moving. In comparison to the Bullets, who are crowding the keyway.
Well, Sibley's had a shocker. He's got 1 point and has missed three out of four from the free throw line. 10 seconds to go to three-quarter time. Can the Wildcats improve on that 22-point lead? Rucker still has time. There's 3 seconds to go and it's a blocking foul on Mark Ellis. His fourth, is it?
That's probably not a bad foul for Mike Ellis, though, because he's only in a three-foul situation. I don't think they're going to... Just watching, the referees will take it from the sideline, and I think if Mike Ellis hadn't have been there, Derek Rucker was going to go for that three-point play.
So the fans here, you wouldn't believe there's 13,000 of them. They're hushed. They're shocked by what the Bullets have done. They've been down by 5 at quarter time, 11 at half time, and despite the fact that this crowd is a Brisbane crowd, it's been all Perth, particularly in this third quarter. The lead now has doubled from 11 points at half time to 22 points.
You have to say as well, though, that apart from the perfunctory cat calls they get occasionally, the crowd has been very generous in its appreciation.
Yes, and something I hope that all Australian basketball crowds everywhere pick up. There really is no need to go overboard with booing players, particularly players being injured or when Australian teams visit. It has become an annoying factor this year, but it's been great to see a crowd appreciate good basketball, and they've had two great games, in fact three if you count the one in Perth.
Now, importantly, in this delay, the game clock has been reset. It was stopped at 3.2 seconds. It is back down to 1.1. So it's a dish out and a shot. Somebody may try to take a foul. May try to go for a block. Sibley turns around and jumps. He makes it. So an encouraging way to finish the third quarter. They've come from being 22 points down to go into the huddle at three-quarter time. 20 in the arrears. 80 plays 60.
Done. Well, almost. Next time, don't just wash your car, revive it. With Wins Revive, just watch. Revive silicone formula beautifies and protects dashboards against aging, hardening and cracking. Outside, tyres, bumpers, and Revive is detergent and water resistant too. So, buy a bottle of Wins Revive and next time, don't just wash your car, revive it.
Because when it's Wins,
it works.
The most fully featured family saloon under Australian skies is under $25,000. The Mazda 626. With air conditioning, power steering, cruise control, power windows, central locking, electric mirrors, and fuel injected 2.2 litre power. all for just $24,990. No wonder it's creating such a storm.
Now, there's a new bank account that does away with juggling money between separate accounts because it replaces them with just one account, does away with the checkbook that doesn't pay interest and gives you the option of one that does, with none of the usual bank transaction charges and keeping fees.
If your bank is costing you money, change your bank. Easy Bank Plus account, one account convenience plus high interest from the R&I.
Chicken treat special.
Hey, hey. Chicken and chips, chicken and corn, Hawaiian back. A chicken dinner. Yo, it's a chicken treat special. Can't you see? Buy any quarterback and get a Coke for free. That's a quarter of chicken in every pack. And a free can of Coke that will wash it back. It's a chicken treat special. Chicken and chips, chicken and corn, Hawaiian back. A chicken dinner. So grab a quarter pack from your chicken treat store. Get a free can of Coke, we're gonna ask for more. Yo, a chicken treat special.
Danny's birthday present wasn't quite what he had in mind, so he traded in Dad's beloved Cedric and bought
a piece of mailing history
for a date with the girl of his dreams.
Don't you try touching her breasts.
They've been taken for a ride by a used car dealer.
The motor blew up.
Now they're taking him for a ride. From the makers of Malcolm comes a comedy for anyone who's ever bought a lemon. The Big Steal.
Now showing. Check newspapers for details.
Around Australia, welcome back. This live and exclusive telecast on the Seven Network and our affiliates. That's the first change in the score since quarter time. Sydney makes two. The Bullets, though, trail by 18. Perth leading 80-62. A special welcome to our regional stations and especially to those people watching in regional Western Australia through the Golden West Network. A valuable defensive head out for Kansas.
That's what the Bullets needed. They needed a jam, they needed something to spark them, and it took Andre Moore until the fourth quarter to produce his aerial display. And it forces Cal Bruton into a timeout.
That's a good timeout from Cal Bruton. The one thing he doesn't want to have happen here is let the crowd get into this game and the momentum to change. So as soon as it's looked like Brisbane are going to get momentum, he's given a cool out period.
Next on Hinch.
Many Australians use credit cards to spend money they do not have.
I don't sleep at night. I can't go to work. I'm very worried.
But the experts say you can get value out of plastic. Customer credit, next on Hinch.
As one of WA's leading financial institutions, Town and Country is deeply committed to our community's quality of life. Mick Malthouse, coach of the West Coast Eagles, has a commitment to excellence in sport. His skill and experience is now a big part of Town and Country's youth development program. Mick is involved in many projects that help the young people of our state grow and develop skills and positive attitudes. Town and Country, we are backing the future of our state because we want them to have every chance in the world.
We have an 18-month-old has fallen down a water well.
The dramatic true story that captured the attention of the world. The rescue of Jessica McClure, Wednesday.
And welcome back. Play just underway for a moment. No change in the score. The Bullets have scored 4 points unanswered since three-quarter time. The difference now 16 points. Ellis goes baseline and scores. And that will delight the Ellis family in Perth. Look at them. They're absolutely wrapped. Robin Ellis and all the relations over there.
Mike's brothers, Glenn and Steve. Brett, of course, is over here on the bench.
And turnover again. Gordon would have been proud.
Yes, indeed.
So it is Ellis who's played a captain's role. For the Bullets to win this game, they have to come back from 20 points down at three-quarter time, which no team has ever done in the history of the NBL. Ellis misses with a three-pointer. Now Moore pulls down a rebound. He's only got six rebounds before that in the whole game. In fact, up to three-quarter time, Rucker was the leading equal rebounder for the Bullets. Equal leading. He had five. So that's an indication of how poorly the Bullets have been blocking out. And their shooting percentage is 48 compared to Perth all game percentage of 65%.
And two Wildcat players in there for the rebound. Their enthusiasm right up there still. They're not going to let this game be torn from their grasp. They're hitting it with everything. The Bullets at this stage really do have to start moving their offense around, looking for the three-pointer, probably from Rucker. And I'd like to see a few screens set for him. They're trying to let him get free on his own without too much screen.
That was amazing.
Yeah, the referees let that one go. And there's another vital rebound pulled down by Perth by Torrance.
The Bullets should never have been allowed to lose a handle on the ball. There they had 3 men to 1.
Now Loggins is matching up on Ellis, the two left-handers.
Grace.
On Grace, I should say. Ellis is on Fox. It's 82-64.
Look at Calbert. On his haunches, up and down. He really hasn't sat down all game, I don't think.
Fox gets the steal off Torrance. Will he go all the way? Yes, he does. Premier Wayne Goss there in the box, the Bullets box. He loved that. So the difference 16 once again. Grace, who's been so dominant in this game.
Must put pressure on the ball in defence. Got to make that clock go and get it down a little fast. Force the shot up before the clock runs down too much.
They're sticking to the same pattern they have all game, not rushing. There's 5 seconds left as Pinder puts up the fadeaway jumper and it's good.
What a shot.
Great shot. 84 play 66.
You really can't use up the clock any better than that. Perth took the air right out of the ball. That was on the buzzer and he whipped his hand. So Perth have used the entire 30 seconds. They still hold this 18-point lead. And John Musgrove, what can the Bullets do to get back?
Well, it's got to start with defense like Perth did on Friday night. They've got to push it up and find something extra deep down to force those turnovers. That's all, because Perth are just scoring virtually at will. They're still hitting about 70% of their shots, and you're not going to come back unless you can force some mistakes.
Well, they've gone for the quick out at this time. Ellis, I thought, might have held it up. That's an intentional. The basket stands. Ellis will get the bonus, and the Wildcats will get possession.
I think that's disappointing for Andre Moore. Although it was in his back there, I think Andre grabbed him as he went through and held him up because he was coming at him fairly fast. More than anything, I was thinking he was trying to stop him, knock him flat over. But the referees had called intentional. He did get into the back. That's what they've
seen. Ellis family liked it back in Perth. I would say everybody watching in Perth would appreciate that. Mike Ellis got the bonus, and more importantly, John, the Wildcats get possession again.
Yeah, that's the last thing I think the Bullets wanted. He got the 2 points, the bonus and possession. You can't do better than that.
So Ellis it is again, guarded this time by Duncan Johnston. He's had limited bench time, but really has made the most of it. Most impressive, that young man, as is Paul Reese. Ellis, I think though perhaps the Wildcats' experience and that will simply carry them through at this stage. The Alabama Slammer does what he does best.
Well, basketball, as we said so many times this weekend, a game of momentum, and really the momentum right on the Wildcats side. I can't see the Bullets really having enough in them to go and change the score at this stage. I think they've got it locked up. All the Wildcats have got to do now is just play smart and keep on playing sensibly as they have all game.
Travel call by Paul Reese. Well, the lead now is 23 points, which is the most it's been in the match.
Tiny Pinder almost fainted then when the whistle went. I think he thought that was number 5.
Yes, he and Loggins both on 4 fouls.
There's just not enough petrol left in the Bullets' tanks at this stage either. Some of the players really running up and down on the spot.
Crawford, who's been simply inspirational, misses that one. Rucker, who always seems to position himself so well for rebounds, gets one across to Fox. And it's a Bullets ball.
Substitution for the Bullets.
Substitution's called. Leroy Loggins comes back into the game. Fox sits down. 7 minutes to go in the game, 89-66.
So I've enjoyed one thing from the Wildcats tonight. It's been their game plan that has worked in offense, that they've spread that ball wide and they've been very patient. And boy, it's a patient dividend. Defensively, though, you can't go past them. When they've held the Bullets at this stage in the game to just 68 points, they're going to hold them to certainly under 100 points, probably down to 90. That's excellent defense.
About as few points as the Bullets would have scored in any game this year.
And of course at this stage the NBL Grand Final winning margin is under threat by the Wildcats.
Inside to Crawford over the top of Reese. He's just unstoppable, the Alabama Slammer. James Crawford now has 16 points.
There's a hush falling over the crowd here too. Most of the noise coming from the first bench.
There's a bit of nail biting going on in the stalls, I think.
Foul called.
I think fairly understandably the crowd gone a bit quiet because there really isn't a whole lot to cheer about at the moment. The Bullets still trying to find that something extra, and said a couple of times they've got to do it in defence, but the Wildcats just playing it so steadily they're not finding anything.
David Close are holding foul, so it's a Bullets ball.
Actually, these two teams have shut up most crowds around the league this year, because after Alan Black was sacked, everyone thought that Perth weren't going to be a force this year. The Brisbane Bullets, everyone wrote them off at the start of the season when they had a whole new lineup.
Perth has certainly shown a new method for starting a season, making it to the finals, going over to Westside and getting beaten so comprehensively by a team that finished at the bottom end of the ladder. Come the other end of the season, however, they're here and right in the box seat now to take out the NBL Championship for the first time ever.
Well, and the blocking foul on Rucker.
Chris McGraw.
The Wildcats bench like it. Had the bonus. So the basket stands, and Crawford will go to the stripe with a chance to make three.
Points count, James Crawford.
While most of the crowd is hushed, there's a few small pockets around the place that are fairly excited at the moment. Perth have brought up that man, I guess, is fairly worried for very good reason. So Perth brought over a core of about 100 fans. Rather, those fans have brought themselves over.
You can imagine quite a big crowd at the airport when they get back, they carry that trophy over with them.
Yes, indeed, around 11:15 tonight. Checked with the airport, with the airlines, Australian Airlines. A three-pointer from Leroy. Does go. So it's a joy for the crowd.
Tip in from James Crawford helped it on its way.
Grace almost took the slap out from Rucker. Grace again. The Wildcats content still just to work down the clock. Don't need to take any risks. Crawford has made the drive. Been fouled as he brought his hands up, so that will be a shooting foul. He should go to the line for two.
With such a huge lead and only minutes remaining before the conclusion of this game, will we see any showtime from Perth?
I don't think so. I think they're totally focused on the job they came here to do. Their game plan obviously didn't work on Friday night,
James,
but it's worked to perfection tonight. It's probably not being unfair to say a couple of players were perhaps overwhelmed by the occasion, may have choked a little on Friday. They have refocused. Credit there to the coaching staff, the team owners and team psychologist Neil McLean. Derek Rucker again. Andre Moore goes over the top and makes two. So Brisbane will not be denied. Pinder, Grace, clever pass from Pinder. Tend not to notice some of the little things every now and again, but that was a little bounce pass in front of the running Grace. Every possession the Wildcats get is absolutely crucial for the Bullets now. They need to break them as much as they can. Not sure how that got to Crawford, but it did. And so he will go to the line once again. Leroy Loggins is five fouls. And the money man exits the ball game with 17 points, 5 rebounds.
And a very frustrated man too, I'd think. This last half just hasn't been the way the Bullets had planned it to be at halftime. Notice even now, just no confidence in the team there. Playing defense instead of doing as the Wildcats did on Friday night by pressing out and putting pressure on the ball, they're allowing the Wildcats players, particularly James Crawford, to move, getting the keyway, and then trying to stop him once he reached the paint. The only thing you're going to do against a player like Crawford and Pinder in the paint is usually foul them, and that's what's been happening.
So Crawford has made the first, 96 plays 73, 23 points to lead again. That doesn't go. Cox brings it forward. It's close alongside him. Johnston, Sibley needs to shoot, goes close to the basket, rejected from Crawford. Great effort by James Crawford once again. Hasn't let up on his intensity at all. Close makes three. Now there is a man with mixed emotions. Nick Rosato from Western Underwriters, who along with the man in the white shirt behind him, Gary Rendell of Radio 6pm and Perth, have to sign a $100,000 check if the Wildcats take this series.
Pity the players don't get too much of that with the salary cap.
Once again, a rebound goes to the Wildcats.
Mike Ellis looking comfortable.
He's enjoying it from a worm's eye view. Leroy Loggins out of the game with 17 points, 5 rebounds, shot 57%, had one assist. 98-73, this is just the last rites really for Perth. I think Brisbane are gone. Close for three, rims out.
He hasn't had much luck with those over the series, has he?
No. Much rucker goes to Johnston, to Moore. Little tip-in attempt by Sydney. Eventually, it's Andre Moore who gets the last touch, and he's now got 16 points. You've got to pay credit to the Wildcats after such a traumatic season.
Traumatic two seasons, really. Oh, yeah. Take last season with the airline dispute and the death of Scott Fenton as well. It's been a hard 2 years for the Wildcats.
His parents are over here. Keith and Pam Fenton over here watching. 98 to 75. And I imagine for Perth being so remote and feeling they're sometimes derided by the rest of the basketball community, they've done a fantastic job. The program over there is so successful.
Well, I read in the program for this final that the Perth team have sometimes felt like the lonely child with their nose pressed up against the window looking in from outside. But they really aren't feeling all that lonely at the moment. The Ellis family, Mike's wife, Rob up in the back. And I'm not sure where baby Cody is at the moment, but I'm sure even baby Cody, Mike's young boy, would be happy now. He'll certainly be wearing his Wildcats uniform at the airport when they come back tonight.
It'd be sweet revenge for Mike Ellis from 1987, because he was there in 1982. He's one of the originals. And, of course, he was in the losing side, as was Cal Britton.
Well, that's right.
1987.
The two men, I guess, who feel the most emotion here today are those two you just mentioned. Cal Britton, who, of course, had the falling out. Maybe the Wildcats are bulletproof after all. And, of course, Mike Ellis. It's been a long time coming, a championship for Mike Ellis. And I try not to show Perth colours, but I have to say he's one guy who does deserve a championship.
The Wildcats have the chance to go into the record books too as the greatest grand final winning team, because the record is only 26 points. They're now leading by 23.
Here's Rucker on the fast break.
And the team that had the biggest winning margin ever in a grand final was the Brisbane Bullets in 1985 when they defeated Adelaide.
Well, Watto tried desperately to stop Rucker, but not foul, and just couldn't get out of the way. And Brian Quill biting his lip. In shooting percentages, they tell the story. Ellis has shot 82%, Grace 62, Crawford 69, and for the Bullets, Rucker 44, Moore 44, and Loggins 57. Enough said.
And so that's got to be credit to the defence. Bullets are used to Boondall, they're used to big crowds, they should be used to the occasion too. They had plenty of opportunity to get used to that on Friday night and win it. So really the credit to the defence of the Wildcats is Watterson scores down the other end, still holding the Bullets under 80 points. They'll probably go pretty close to keeping them there for the entire game. To hold a team like the Bullets to under 80 points in any game is a very, very credible defensive effort.
Andre Moore with a long-range shot. One thing, John, I felt after game two was that the Bullets starting five played a lot of minutes, and whereas Cal Britton has rotated his players a lot more in this series. And I know we say that the Bullets played successfully at the end of the season with 4 games in 10 days, but they look heavy-legged out there today.
Yeah, I don't know that makes much of a difference. I think they've just been outplayed. I don't think they've been weary or anything. They've proven they can play all year with those type of statistics. So I don't think it should take away the defensive pressure that Perth have put on them.
Robert Sibley pulls down a rebound. He's had 5 rebounds in this quarter. Rucker misses. Fox does too. It comes back to Ricky Grace. Darren Breeding's on there. That's good to see, because his parents, John and Jan, are over here. He paid their fares all the way from Adelaide. Former South Australian young Darren, so he's getting a bit of
those girls glory. Paid their own fares, the Perth Wildcats cheer squad, and they've certainly had their ambition realised. Their ambition was to support the team in a grand final win. It's a shame that only 6 of them could come over. But credit the Perth supporters who donated very generously to the whip around.
I think they're as good as any cheer girl squad that I've seen. Their dancing is fantastic.
Mike Ellis comes out of the game. He knows that his team has got this one. Pete Hansen, who's been in the squad all year but hasn't actually been on the team list, has trained with them. An American playing in Perth for the Perry Lakes Hawks. And he's been a marvellous acquisition to the side in terms of what you might call in boxing a sparring partner. Provides Bob, they use him as a sort of an entree more to train against.
I was just thinking that plane trip back, Dave, you're going to have one very, very happy plane. It's normally a very long trip, of course, from Brisbane or anywhere on the East Coast back to Perth, but I don't think it'll be more enjoyed at any time throughout the season than the trip back there tonight.
No, it'll be a fairly wet flight. I have to admit I'm staying on tonight at Brisbane Hospitality. The Wildcats will be going back commentatorless, which I don't think will do them any harm at all.
I wouldn't fancy being a stewardess on that flight.
The team owners have come down to the bench, Bob Williams and Kerry Stokes. Kerry Stokes already congratulating the players. I'm going to say the job isn't done yet.
Certainly
Greg
Fox
must be trying. 102 plays 81.
And I can't emphasise again the defensive effort. 117 points average score of the Brisbane Bullets throughout this season. That means that there's 37 or 36 points or so they've restricted them from their scoring average throughout the season. That really is a mighty job, because when you look at the game, you will tend to look at the offensive prowess of the Wildcats, a great shooting percentage from the field, which was excellent. But boy, they really started it at the hard work end.
They say Brisbane are a three-man team with Rucker, Loggins and Moore. Well, two of those have fouled out. Loggins with 17 points, Moore with 18 points. And both of them shot well below their normal shooting average from the field. Rucker shot, at least Moore shot 44% from the field. 1.5 minutes to go.
One player I'm so thrilled for in the Perth Wildcats lineup is James Crawford. He has been one of the elite players, if not alongside Leroy Loggins, the elite player of the 80s and now into the 90s. And it would have been just an injustice had he gone through an NBL career here in Australia without ever having claimed a title. Congratulations, James Crawford.
So the youngsters are on.
You have
Craig
to feel,
Evans too.
I was going to say, you have to feel for those guys to play in a grand final team. And James Crawford shooting at will now. 105 plays 83. Crawford has 24. Grace, still the game high scorer with 25, hasn't scored this quarter.
Greg Fox is doing a little bit of what he did in game two, where he came out and shot the lights out of game one in Perth, where he shot 20 points, most of which came in the last quarter.
That's the charge. The Wildcats really can't do anything wrong at the moment.
And they forced him into that to set the screen in the right position and drove the player into Greg Fox into that screen. So it was a good defensive setup that. But credit also to the Bullets tonight. They've gone through a season, as you said, they weren't even predicted by most people to finish in the top six, and they've come through to the championship once again. A feeling in Brisbane that it's the start of a new dynasty. Brian Curl has a team here that has a lot of room for growth and improvement, and I think they'll be a big danger come 1991 season. As will the Wildcats be very keen to defend that title, of course.
Well, the pictures are saying it all at the moment, and Robbie Dempster is the man who's going to the charity strike. Much travelled player, as we said before in this telecast, originally from Manjimup, and the people from Manjimup will be having a ball in the moment. And the Ellis family are enjoying it. It's about time to get Cody out of the cot, I think, Robin. Bring him up to the television set to watch his dad pick up that trophy.
I notice the champagne's out there.
Give him a taste of champagne.
Yeah, I've only seen Mike Ellis carry away one major trophy. It was at the Crown Prince tournament in Bangkok in 1985 when the Wildcats represented Australia. On that occasion, when Mike picked the trophy up, he broke it.
What a shot off the glass.
Darren Breedy becoming an expert in that last three-point shot in the end quarter.
As I said, the last trophy Mike Ellis picked up, he broke. I can bet you London to a brick. He won't break this one. 16 seconds left in the 1990 Hungry Jacks National Basketball League season. The clock has been stopped with 13.9 on it. Eric Watterson will go to the line to shoot a one-on-one, but it's academic.
You should see the Perth bench. I mean, the photographers are here, the owners are here, the cheer girls are going berserk. And for the Brisbane Bullets, well, winners are grinners, and losers can please themselves.
Well, they've been very, very good losers. Two, I think, the most worthy championship contention sides in the league. Watterson makes them. And so it's 109 to 86.
Don't worry, there'll be some celebrations tonight in Brisbane Town too.
These are the death throes. Sibley, the intercept comes from David Close. Eric Watterson, can he score the last basket? Gives it to Robbie Dempster. Sibley lets it go. The clock strikes zero. And the Perth Wildcats are the 1990 Hungry Jacks National Basketball League champions by a margin of 23 points, 109 to 86. It's been a marvellous year of basketball, and I would say a fitting three-game series to end it on, Peter.
Yes, it's almost deja vu. In 87, the second game score was 106 to 87 to Brisbane. The other way around, congratulations to Perth. Well done. They've come back from adversity after losing the second game by 16 points.
For the Brisbane Bulls.
The crowd here, well, they're giving Perth due credit, which is great to see. 13,000 people here at the entertainment centre.
That's a great sight. That is a great sight.
The best of friends. We saw that when they first saw each other over in Perth. Like old buddies. They were teammates, of course, back in 85 when they won the title for the Brisbane Bullets.
Jeff Allen on crutches in the shirt and tie in the background has stuck with the team despite his dreadful Achilles tendon injuries this year. And to be fair, the team have stuck with him. They brought him across. They brought every member of their squad across. This is a very special moment for Carl Bruton and his guys.
For Brian Kerr and his team, bad luck, but they've done well just to get to the grand final. But Perth, congratulations. Their first ever NBL title in the 12th year of the competition. Into the huddle with Mike Ellis. They're enjoying the moment, savouring every little sweet bit of it. Let's go to a break. Perth the champions in 1990.
Will Fisher follow the letter of the law?
You wouldn't be so mean as to let us do the whole exam and then fail us.
Carly and Ben's new job won't win any friends.
Sorry, I didn't realise.
It's an invasion of privacy, that's what it is.
And Grant's baffled by Blake's game of deception.
Well, what on earth would he have to gain by lying?
Home and Away, 7 o'clock Monday.
Now, there's a new bank account that does away with juggling money between separate accounts because it replaces them with just one account that earns terrific interest calculated daily. But, unlike others, this amazing account is free of all the usual bank transaction charges and keeping fees.
If your bank is costing you money, change your bank. Easy Bank Plus Account. One account convenience plus high interest from the R&I.
You're looking for something special. Here it is, the ultimate pan pizza. Pizza Hut Grand Pan Pizza. Not eight, not nine, but 10 delicious toppings. And right now, you can have garlic bread, a jug of Pepsi, and medium Grand Pan for just $16.90. Grand Pan Pizza. 10 toppings deep all over, just waiting for you at Pizza Hut. Dine-in, takeaway, or home delivered.
Kmart is the best value toy store in Australia. You'll find all the famous toy brands and all the most wanted toys. And every toy is at Kmart's discount prices. As well as Australia's biggest and best value Christmas bear at $28, these lovable bears are also available for only $18 if you buy $35 worth of merchandise. There's no deposit lay-by. You can pick up the toys Christmas Eve. So, who's Australia's best value toy store by far?
Each year, Town and Country WA is proud to be a major sponsor of Junior Surf Lifesaving, so that in future there'll always be someone there when a life is in danger off our beaches. So, if you're one of over 200,000 members of Town and Country, you too can take pride in supporting the training of tomorrow's lifesavers. They deserve the support you help us to give them.
Town and Country,
see those clouds rolling across the top of Perth.
You can see Alison's got that medical breakthrough.
It means a cure for this serious disease.
The Olympic Games in Barcelona. Should I move that one up there?
Unless this question is within a judge made.
Their claim. Step by 6-7.
Coming out in 5. Fans distraught. Fan 4.
It's a great story.
3.
Step by 6-2.
Good evening. Also on 790 News.
Relive the excitement of the Wildcats' victory, including the arrival home, 10:55 tonight.
Welcome back. As I said, there was one shot at glory this afternoon. The Perth Wildcats grabbed it with both hands. They led at every change and certainly deserved their great victory this afternoon. They led by 5 at quarter time. They extended it at half time. And by the end of the fourth quarter, it was a 23-point deficit and a brilliant win for the Perth Wildcats this afternoon. They deserve all the accolades that are going to be heaped on them over the next few days. And I'm certain they'll be celebrating long and hard, not only tonight, but when they return to Perth to their legion of fans over there. Let's go out to a lot of fans of the Brisbane Entertainment Centre who are a little bit disappointed, but giving their due credit to Perth. Peter Mears is out there amid the celebrations.
Yes, Perth are the champions for 1990, their first ever title, 109-86. To make the official presentations, here's the Brisbane Bullets public address announcer, Neil Hamilton-Smith.
Ladies and gentlemen, for the official presentation for the 1990 Hungry Jacks National Basketball League, would you kindly welcome the General Manager of the National Basketball League, Bill Palmer.
Another great year for Bill Palmer as he makes his way to the microphone.
Mr. Premier, Lord Mayor, ladies and gentlemen,
It's my pleasure to introduce, firstly, Graham Ballantyne, the state managers from the league's major naming rights sponsor, Hungry Jacks, who will present the runner-up trophies to the Brisbane Bullets. Graham Ballantyne, please. Firstly, the captain, Mr. Money, Leroy Loggins. Andre Moore.
Well, the big guy
Derek
has had a
Rucker.
Couple of great games. Ruck has won so many games for the Bullets this season, he couldn't quite do it tonight.
His moment of glory will come at the NBL
Robert
annual dinner.
Sibley.
I think he might get the MVP for the year, Derek Rucker.
Robert Sibley, his legs just ran out on him. He'll come back next year. Won't require surgery either. It's
Paul Rees.
Well, one of the stars of the future, and I tip this guy for a boomer singlet.
Chris
not too
McGraw.
Far distant future.
Guts effort from Chris McGraw this season. Came into the squad by his own admission, 20, 25
Johnston.
Kilograms overweight.
After 3 years of not playing, too. Another rookie, Duncan
Greg
Johnston,
Fox.
Who was injured in game two, but he's got a lot of talent.
The most underestimated player in the Bullets lineup, Greg Fox.
Craig Adams.
Pretty upset too, young Greg.
He had a great playoff, much better than his season, really lifted his
Darren
game in the playoffs.
Another Spider Adams, who's got his own fan club.
Six feet 10 inches, lad. He's a player
Steve
of the
McCall.
Future as well.
Champagne is starting to flow in the Wildcats camp. I can feel it raining here.
Chris Clarkson.
Big dog, Steve McLeod from Bundaberg. Get more court time next year,
assistant
I imagine.
Assistant coach,
as well, Chris
Clarkson. David Claxton.
Ricky Grace is on the phone to the USA, a mobile phone. There he is.
Manager Fred Van Rogen.
Back to Dallas. The wonders of telecommunications. And one
and
of the longest serving managers in the
Brian
league.
Brian Curl.
Freddie Van Donzen coming up. Brian Curl. Acknowledging the crowd. Acknowledging the support of the Brisbane people who have been fantastic.
It was said at the end of last season, a poll was taken at a radio station in Brisbane, said 70% of people thought Brian Curl should have been dropped. I reckon now at the end of this season, those 70% might have been reconsidering those
votes. It's pretty hard to
stay right.
We didn't try our best. Perth was the better team on the day. We wish those guys the best of luck. I'd just like to say that we're a young team and the 90s are going to be mighty. We'll be back. It's only the beginning. Thank you.
Perhaps prophetic words from Leroy Loggins. He may not be getting any younger, but there's so much youth in this squad at this stage. Let's remember on the cleanouts last year, the Brisbane Bullets went from being one of the oldest teams in the league to being the youngest.
Basketball league, Malcolm Speed.
Mal Speed, the chairman of the NBL.
Mr. Premier, my Lord Mayor, 1990 has been another great year in the history of the National Basketball League. Would you give the very worthy winners of the 1990 Hungry Jacks National Basketball League, the Perth Wildcats, a very sporty, very loud acknowledgement of their great effort in winning this year's title.
Trevor Torrance and some of the fans who've come over from Perth.
The National Basketball League thanks its naming rights sponsor, Hungry Jacks, great supporters of the National Basketball League, the sponsors of the final series, Kmart, again, great supporters of basketball. Again, would you show your appreciation of their support for basketball? Finally, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the National Basketball League, we congratulate you, the best crowd in the National Basketball League, 26,000 people over 2 days. Well done.
Yes, indeed, as we said, 33,000 people have seen this series live.
And millions more like you watching at home.
And finally, at the start of the season, many of the people who knew said that not much was expected of the Brisbane Bullets this year.
a season of rebuilding. Again, would you show your appreciation? They got within one game of the ultimate prize, the Brisbane Bulls.
Yes, it makes you wonder.
Ladies and gentlemen, there's three more awards ceremonies to be made. Firstly, to congratulate the 1990 Hungry Jack's NBL champions, the Perth Wildcats. I'll call up firstly their captain and inspirational leader, Mike Ellis. Getting his championship ring. A long time for Mike Ellis to get up on this dais. Eric Watterson. Tiny Pinder.
Here he comes, wearing the net.
I think one of the keystones to this victory, definitely 11 rebounds tonight, and he was almost unstoppable on the offensive
James
board.
Crawford.
He had 24 points in the game, 6 rebounds.
Trevor Torres.
Did a great job of containing Leroy Loggins in conjunction with David Close.
May take a little bit longer, unfortunately, hurt before the grand final series, the big man, Jeff Allen.
Well, it's going to be fun to see him get up the riser to accept it, but he's come all this way with the team. I don't think he's going to let a little thing like a leg and pass to stop him now.
He doesn't have to climb up there. He's tall enough to look at him eye to eye from down the floor.
And he'll be back again next year.
The quiet achiever of the Perth Wildcats coming up now, Steve Davis.
Ricky Grace.
Born in Queensland, too.
And perhaps, along with Derek Rucker, the best recruit in the NBL in 1990.
Brett Ellis.
Brett didn't get to put his singlet on in this game, but he has tears in his eyes, Brett, along with everybody else in the Ellis family. And this has been a long time coming for them.
Craig Evans.
The late Gordon Ellis, one of the men responsible for the Wildcats in those early years.
Rob Dempster.
Everything comes to those who sit and wait.
Robbie hasn't sat to wait. What a great moment for this young man. David Radar Close, his first season in the NBL, and to take the championship
Assistant
with him.
Assistant coach David Hancock.
It's been a tough year for this guy, brought in with Cal Bruton.
And head coach Cal Bruton.
Sweet rebound.
And a big cheer for Cal Bruton as well from the Brisbane crowd. They know a hero when they see one.
The last time Cal was here, they booed him in 1987. He has that
memory. We have now to present from Kmart, Kim Chowney, the regional manager for the Kmart store, will present the MVP for the final series award. That's in a vote that's taken over the three final games.
Ricky Grace
and
or Tiny Pinder?
And the winner of the Kmart Grand Final Series MVP, Ricky Grace.
Yes, indeed. Well, he would only just have shaded Tiny Pinder. But it's certainly deserved, and Derek Rucker could have figured in there as well.
Yes, he started the season slowly. I think they had him in the wrong position initially.
Well, in tonight's game, he must have gone very close to getting a triple-double because he had 9 rebounds, and I'm sure he had over 10 assists and 25 points.
National Basketball League Perpetual Trophy.
In fact, at halftime, Ellis and Grace had more assists between them than the entire Bullets team, 17-9. Well, that's one heck of a trophy. Dr. John Rashke, Perpetual Trophy. And for the first time, it's held off by a Perth Wildcat.
Only the 7th team in the history of the competition to win that honour, the Perth Wildcats.
I'd like to firstly thank the 11th man for the Brisbane Bullets. Everyone out there, it was a hell of an effort. You gave us a hell of a fright on Friday night, but I think it's a credit to the team, the way we've come back. We worked damn hard for this, and as far as I'm concerned, the players that deserve 100% of the credit have done a fantastic job, and I'd like to thank every one of them. Thank you.
Interestingly, nobody has left the stadium.
Ladies and gentlemen, that does it for 1990. We'll all be back, same players, same teams, for a great season in 1991. Until then, have a good holidays, and we'll see you next year.
So congratulations to Mike Ellis. They're in tears in the Perth camp. Jubilation. Extreme excitement.
And they're about to pick up a trip for $100,000.
The Robin Ellis family, congratulations. You've done your bit all the way across the continent. And well done all Perth people who supported their team throughout this rather troubled time. They're the champions this year for the first time in their history. Let's go now back to Paddy Welsh, and he's going to have a word to Robin Ellis.
Peter, thank you very much. Great scenes over there, and Robin, we've been trailing you all the way through this game, and the excitement must be, you must be almost not able to contain yourself and the family right at this moment.
Oh, it certainly is unbelievable. I wish we were all over there, but of course we can't be. So, no, that was fantastic, and I really believe we earned that. We played well right from the start of the game, and I think it was great. And Brisbane is a good team, and if we can beat them, then we certainly deserve it. It was great.
Well, I love you over here for saying that. What's planned when the guys get home? What are the plans for the celebrations?
Oh, I don't know. My husband doesn't even drink, but I'm sure he's going to get stuck into the champagne this afternoon. I think the Perth Entertainment Centre is going to have a big party and things like that, and I'm sure all the Wildcat fans will be at the airport.
It's just so close to the Ellis family, this Perth Wildcats team, is that you've been there since 82, since the inception. It's been, you've been through troubled times, and to have the first championship, it must be just a great relief.
It is a great relief, and I wish Mike's dad was here to see it all too, but I'm sure he's still watching it and really proud of all the guys.
Was there any stage that you were worried there at all, Robin?
Not really.
Seemed to have it pretty well won right the way through, didn't they?
Yes, I think we always say if we can get up in that first quarter, then we seem to, you know, we keep it up the next three quarters, and we seem to play well right from the beginning. So there wasn't really any doubt. We were pretty confident all the way through.
All right, Robin, we thank you very much for your time this afternoon. We appreciate your comments. I know you're about to crack a few bottles of champagne over there yourself. So congratulations on behalf of the guys, and I know they'll be back with you very shortly to maybe you can even talk Michael into having one little glass of champagne.
Oh, I'm sure
I will. We're going back to Boondall now. There's still celebrations going on out there.
Thanks, Pat. Congratulations, Robin, and the whole Ellis family. Let's go straight to the man behind the Perth Wildcats. How sweet it must be. I know there's a frame in his office that's empty. David Christensen, you're with Cal Bruton.
That empty frame in your office is going to be filled, buddy.
Most definitely. There was quite a few photos taken, and I'm looking forward to taking it down and putting the picture in it with that championship trophy.
I know it's not easy to single out individuals, but he did have a bad game on Friday night. Mike Ellis came back and played a real captain's game tonight.
He sure did, and no one more deserving of a championship ring and the trophy than Mike Ellis. He's been through the 9 years in the league and sort of battling through the lean times, and now all of a sudden, you know, after 4 years when the times have changed and still knocking at the door and not getting one, it's finally come fruitful. So he's a very happy man.
It's been an emotional year. It's been an emotional 2 years. You are an emotional team without doubt. How are you going to celebrate this?
Well, I'm looking forward to getting back to Perth and celebrating with our fans there who've been tremendous to us all year long, and the sponsors, of course. And I just like to say, you know, it's been a hard, long year, and the guys dealt with so much adversity. And for us to come through and come home with the trophy, I'm looking forward to partying week one, week two, week three, until we get back into the season again.
I guess you're not thinking too much about 1991 at this stage, but are there likely to be any changes?
Well, you're right. I haven't thought about it, and you know, I have no comment at this stage. I'm just happy that you know, we can celebrate this moment, and just let's savor this moment in 1990 rather than look ahead just yet.
What about the performance of Ricky Grace, MVP for the series?
Well, you know, Ricky was my prize pick. You know, I went and handpicked him myself, and he's been a blessing. And you know, everyone nicknamed him not so amazing at the beginning of the year. And, you know, he just steadily just built on it until he showed us what he's all about in the end. And it was a deserving award for him as well.
You spoke before this second and third game started of the three guys who had 24 years between them, Mike, Tiny and James Crawford. Glenn Palmer said during the commentary it would have been a tragedy if they'd gone through their careers without a championship. It's come true.
They put so much into the game. I mean, you know, James with his clinics, Tiny with just his showmanship, and of course Mike with you know, just the grassroots of basketball and WA. He was the only identity for years. So those guys, more than anything, are deserving. And again, you know, there was a lot of hardship in this team, and I just can't think of anyone really willing themselves to win more than we have. And we got beat on Friday by a better team, and we came back with a bit angry at ourselves for letting it slip. And it was very tense moments this morning when we had our pregame, but the guys just really hung in there.
Okay, buddy, enjoy the flight home, enjoy the celebrations in Perth tonight.
No worries,
well
I will.
Congratulations.
Man. Thank you.
Thanks, Cal Britton. Well, the pictures tell the story, don't they? John Musgrove, it was an emotional contest right throughout. Two very emotional teams that play very similar styles of basketball. I think very entertaining for fans of basketball right around Australia. Your summary of this final game, what was it? What was the key that won it for Perth?
Well, to go back to the keys to victory, they stuck to their game plan very well. They were patient in offense. They made the nice, easy shots, and they really extended their defense. As I said, to hold the Bullets to 86 points when they're averaging throughout the year 117 points, it really was built from that defensive end.
Glenn, I know you had a question.
I was just wondering how Cal Brewton feels this time round. He won a title in 85. Does it feel any different? How do you think, Dave?
Well, I suppose for him, after so much criticism over the last couple of years, and perhaps his position was in jeopardy, Dave.
Well, I don't know whether it was in jeopardy. There was some talk around the town over the last couple of days, but, if it's not broke, you don't fix it, do you?
Well, there it is. Perth are the champions for 1990. This is Peter Mears at Burndall on behalf of the commentary team, returning you to Pat Welsh.
Thanks to Peter Mears out there, John Musgrove, Glenn Palmer, and also our special guest from Perth, Dave Christensen, just as excited as the team. And as you can see, the tears flowing almost as freely as the champagne at Boondall this afternoon, but they're certainly, as far as the Perth Wildcats are concerned, tears of joy. 23-point winners over the Brisbane Bullets in the final game of the NBL series, or grand final series for 1990. We certainly hope you've enjoyed our coverage on 7, live and exclusive right around Australia. And in the meantime, this is Pat Welch bidding you a very good afternoon.
This has been a 7 Sport production.
The 1990 NBL playoffs are presented by the Good Times and Great Taste of McDonald's, the Swan Brewery, makers of EMU Export Lager, and Mazda, unrivaled quality, pure pleasure.
It's close, goes under the basket, and makes his first score for the Perth Wildcats. Crawford, slam!
Three-point effort by Ricky Grace,
good
turn off the glass.
Watterson tries from three-point range and six it. One on three. He's got all the way to the baseline. Nice work by the Wildcats.
The Cats now hold the victory cup. Well done, guys. You've done the state proud and taught the Bullets how to play basketball. Congratulations from all of us here in the West.